Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to another episode of the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast. I'm your host D.
This is Juice.
What's going on, peoples? Sorry, man. You know, we had to take the definite hiatus, man. That was crazy, man.
Yeah.
Seriously, we haven't recorded, like, it's been like a month and a half. Actually, we have. We just, due to technical issues, we couldn't put out those episodes.
Hopefully, those technical issues are now handled.
And that's fine. I mean, end of the summer, people, you know, going out of town, taking vacations. You know, nothing wrong with that. You know what I mean?
Yeah, we had to take a breather. Yeah.
But we're back.
It's episode number 9.
Is it number 9? I can't recall anymore. I don't know.
Oh, man.
Don't be called out on that.
All right. Pretty sure it's number 9.
It's 10, motherfucker. Damn, that's crazy, man. What's going on, man?
Nothing much, yo. Just,
day-to-day
nothing
living.
Much, you know what I'm saying? I've been working on this, like, all day. I've been working on this this Reaper program, trying to set it up for recording. So we have, like, two systems running, recording this podcast, and pretty much where my head's been for the last...
Man, hopefully that solves our technical issue problem, because we've been having some problems. I can't really complain, because I don't do a lot of the work. You know, that's all Juice, but hopefully that's out of the way, because we did record something, another episode, and shout outs to our co-host Ace. She's not able to make it here with us tonight.
Yeah, not feeling too hot, but yo,
feel better, Ace.
Peace.
All right,
blessings.
And come on back. All right, because we ain't done. We got some more arguing to do. Okay, because it's all good. But shout outs to Ace. But yeah, we did record another episode that got lost to the annals of time.
Just technology.
Technical problems. So we're back. Yeah, man, we're going to start off with a couple topics, man. We're trying to keep it loose and fluid tonight instead of trying to linger on one too many things.
It was hard to pick what to go on because so much stuff has happened in the month or so that we've been gone, man. Like, so many things have passed by. So much stuff to talk about.
But. Crazy, man. And I think in lieu of it being NFL season, started Thursday night, the official Sunday kickoff NFL season being tomorrow, I think we'd be good to start off with Colin Kaepernick and his not standing for the national anthem. I know we're a little bit late. This happened probably about 2 weeks ago now, back in the preseason. Regular season about to start. Nobody cares about preseason anymore, but I thought it was still an interesting issue, man. What are your thoughts on it?
I think it was one of the most powerful movements we've seen in sports history recently. Like, I don't want to overshadow in case anything else happened recently, but this immediately makes me think of Muhammad Ali and how he had to stand up during the whole Vietnam War, and he was against all those things. Like, I'm not for these things, you know? And he was so vocal about it. And it's cool seeing Kaepernick take not the same stance, but at the same time, take a principled stance, you know?
That's exactly. A principled stance.
Yeah.
That's exactly it. And, yeah, I mean, that's cool, man, because I think it probably is one of the biggest statements to be made by an athlete. I mean, and the cool thing about it is it's a peaceful protest almost. You know, he's just not standing. You know what I mean? Like, he's not holding a sign, walking down the street with his AK-47 or something. You know, he's not being too boisterous and, you know, screaming black power everywhere and all that. I mean, even though that's what he believes.
Of course, I did hear he had these, he had some socks on, like a couple, you heard about that, Jeff?
I heard that.
He had the pigs and the police hat
had, like,
on the socks.
Or something on that joint. But, I mean, it's like, we can't classify we can't put every police officer. One thing I disagree with Colin Kaepernick on, we can't put police officers in general into this kind of bottle where we just think, okay, police officers are racist or they're all pigs.
No.
You know, I think I told a story on the podcast before. I got pulled over once just for a minor violation. They told me my goddamn air refresher thing in the rearview mirror was illegal, which it probably is, but I mean, come on, bro, who doesn't have something hanging from their rearview mirror? You know what I mean?
Anybody,
I pulled everybody over for that. But anyway, I'm not gonna cry about a profiling or anything like that. But anyway, I was talking to the cop on the side, man. He was like, "Look, man, you know, I know you're trying to go to work, like you said, everything." He's like, "They're about to foreclose on my house, you know. I'm having problems at home myself, man." He's like, "Look, if you have anything, of course, because of course they searched me." He said, "Man, if you have anything in the car, just let us know now, and we can get on our way, man. You know, nobody's trying to." I'm looking at this dude like, you know, that's kind of cool. He kind of leveled with me a little bit. You know what I mean? Like, you know, he's going through his own things. You know, some police officers are genuinely just trying to do their job and, you know, do their, you know, be good at their profession. They're not out to, kill, you know, people or disrespect black people, a lot of it has to do with where you're from and, you know, where, if you're used to dealing with the people you're policing or not. You know what I mean?
Wait a minute. So he pulled you over because you had some shit in your rearview mirror, and then he searched you.
I should add the caveat. They claim they smell weed. I play the fifth on that. You know what I mean? I don't know whether they... What, anyway, that's what they said.
Man, I'm just saying. They put... Wait, first off...
But they definitely searched me, yeah.
Yo, all right. So, I'm sorry. But that's not fucking okay. Like, that's profiling right there. Like, if there's another case of profiling, that was profiling. He pulled you over, not because he smelled shit. He pulled you over because you had some shit in your window.
Because I asked him, like, why did y'all pull me over? My tail light's not out. My headlights are on. I had my seatbelt on. Like, why'd you pull me over?
And you were in Virginia on the freeway?
I was on 234 right here. This is when I lived in Dumfries. For people who might not know where we are, you know what I mean? We're in Northern Virginia. Yeah, all right. So, anyway.
Not all cops are bad and shit, but that's kind of fucked up.
Yeah, I mean, anyway, but yeah, not all cops are bad, and we can't just paint them all with the same paintbrush like they're all pigs, and, you know. A lot of it depends on where you're from, man. I mean, if you're from southern Kentucky, rural Kentucky, and there hasn't been a lot of forward thinking as far as racial relations go, you know, you still really have your barriers up as far as, you know, these are the white people, these are the black people, you know. Like, from our area where we're from, it's a lot more mixed up, you know what I mean?
Yeah, we're pretty diverse out here.
It's a diverse area.
But, yeah. But
you can't say that about all places, because, I mean, even look at a place like New York, it's as diverse as you can get, right? But you have your black neighborhoods, you have your white neighborhoods, you know?
Yeah, and make sure you're in the right area.
It always boils down to where you are. Otherwise, you get pulled over
for some shit in your rearview mirror. Mm-hmm. So, like, that's definitely happened to me before, and that just reminds me of Philando Castile. Like, I'm not going to go on a Belize-bashing tirade, but it does remind me that we talked about Philando Castile. Remember, he was pulled over, like in the course of, like, I don't remember how many years, 5 years? They pulled him over 50-something times.
A lot of times.
For minor violations, many of which were thrown out of court because they were obviously bullshit.
Mm-hmm.
So, it's cops do profile. Look, we have to ask, all we want is to ask the police to treat us with the same courtesy as we treat them. Well, we're not going to assume all cops are racist, bigoted killers. But when they start profiling people based pretty much on skin color and pulling over for something in the rearview mirror, or for whatever reason they decide to pull you over, you're asking for some of that profiling, you know what I'm saying, in that way.
Mm-hmm.
It's a bad cycle, and all people want is a little bit of a reciprocation, you know? Like, treat us like human beings, and we'll treat you like police officers.
Black people,
you know,
should do a better job. Some black people. I don't want to classify all, same as I don't want to classify all police officers, but some black people should do a better job at just complying with what the officer asks. You know what I mean? I think we talked about this before, man. We covered this before. It's blame to go on both sides in certain cases. You know, I remember, speaking of Philando Castile, I remember when we first saw that video. I think I was sitting at work, and I was just scrolling Facebook, and I just saw it. You know what I mean? And it was just on there, like, Philando Castile. I think somebody reposted it. I don't even know if it was Facebook. I think it might have been Instagram. I'm scrolling through, man. And, like, just to see that gun sticking in that window and hear the cop screaming, because you can't see his face. And this dude's just all over there. Oh,
he slumped, already hurt.
Thank
already
God
shot.
We couldn't see the little girl in the back, the little kid in the back seat. The girl, she was calm, yes, but she looked in shock. That was just a surreal video, man.
Like, it was.
That was crazy.
Like, you were watching that, like, it looked like it was something out of a movie. Like you were watching, like, some first-person, like, live-action video, and they're recording this crazy scenario that's happening, and it's like, how did this happen? This guy...
How?
And then she explains the situation, and you're like, what the fuck? And you're looking at the cop, and he's freaking the hell out. Because he doesn't know how the fuck he shot him.
Did he make a move and made the cop think he was going to go for his gun? How did it get to the point where this cop's sticking his gun in the window, like, while he's seated? And
did he misfire? Like, but why would you have your gun out in the first place, you know?
Exactly, he's seated.
It's like, yeah, come on, man.
I don't get it.
Back to it. But yo, this is the same. So you sent a video earlier in our group with Shannon Sharp.
Mm-hmm.
And he's giving this, passionate tirade on, what was it?
I like that joint. He was making some good points.
Yeah, he made some very good points, and pretty much one of the main points he made, like, some of them I agreed with, some of them I didn't, but one of the main points he made was, he was talking about how how black people are being victimized. And and when you see something like somebody like Kaepernick doing this, it's because we see and we're being victimized. And what you don't want to do is tell black people, oh, we don't believe you. You know what I'm saying? Either as a police officer or either as a just another person of another race. You know, somebody, if it's a snake you haven't recognized, then you have to at least make an attempt to understand that this is a scenario that a certain group of people are facing, and to say that they're not doing it is really discrediting you because you're ignoring the views of a group of people who are experiencing something you're not experiencing. You can't say, oh, you're not experiencing that from another perspective. Yeah.
Yeah, you have to acknowledge it.
You have to be at least acknowledge it and then do something to try to fix it.
It's crazy, man. Back to Colin Kaepernick, he said he was sitting for the anthem. He didn't want to stand up. The reporter asked him about it. And then, of course, immediately everybody goes to Google the national anthem. You know what I mean? So we see the whole third stanza without even, what the hell's a stanza?
It's a segment of a, it's like a set of bars, you know? So you have a...
So is it the same as a verse? So, all right. So yeah, so everybody Googles the third verse or stanza of the national anthem and you're like, oh, you know what I mean?
Like, oh my.
It's not as offensive, I think, as, you know, in your face as some other, but it does make mention to slaves and...
But that was an interesting part of history I never realized. It was saying how the black slaves had joined up with the other army and were fighting against America. Like, I understand that, you know what I'm saying? Like, because they weren't treated like humans. Mm-hmm. So you come up with another group.
If you're offering me, if these white people over here have me chained up and in bondage, and this set of white people over here saying, hey, if you come fight for me, you'll be free after all this.
We'll give you some land, let you be free.
We won't imprison you. Or, you know, enslave you. Hell yeah, I'm going to go fight. You know what I mean? Why wouldn't I, you know?
So my cousin's still not there. I'm going to get them. Yeah.
I don't want to return to bondage, right? So, but I mean, you know, it's like, yeah, now I see, man. Do you know they don't do the Pledge of Allegiance in schools anymore? I heard that, at least in the state of Virginia, I believe, or maybe it's Prince William County, they don't do the Pledge of Allegiance. Oh, wow. I'm like, what is the Pledge of Allegiance? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. And to the republic for which it stands, one nation,
under God, for liberty and justice for all. But here's the thing. So I don't know if you remember, but so I grew up Jehovah's Witness. Mm-hmm. So I never pledged the flag. I never sang the national anthem. I never did any of those things growing up because of how I was raised. Mm-hmm. And it was weird. So I remember looking at this Kaepernick situation like, all right, so... How all of a sudden is it because he said it was, the reason he did it was because of police brutality that all of a sudden everybody got up in arms? Or was it because he didn't stand and salute? Because there have been groups of people, not only Jehovah's Witnesses, but other groups of people who don't, salute the flag or, you know, pledge allegiance or do any of those things for whatever their reasons, religious or other, you know? There have always been groups of people who haven't done that. But it's weird that they singled out Kaepernick for this national spotlight.
I think he's specifically pointed out police, you know, cops are killing people and being given paid leave, you know, for killing people. But maybe he was taking a stand against the message or the, you know, whatever you want to call it, that the national anthem represents, you know. I'm not sure. He didn't. Besides that first initial press conference, I haven't really seen anything. And plus, this guy's way out there on the West Coast. I think also a lot of it lends itself to the popularity and the absolute media monster that the NFL is. I mean, people That's pay true. Attention to the NFL, old white racist people, old racist black people, you know.
Young.
Because black people could be racist, too.
I mean, young hippie libs. You know what I'm saying? Everybody watches like that.
It's a lot more focused. Like, if Kirk Cousins, a quarterback for the Redskins, does something, it's going to blow up, you know, because of this, the how many eyeballs are on it.
You were saying, it was a massive platform.
And plus, it's right before the season, massive platform, millions of people. So, yeah, I think that's why they're focusing on Colin a little bit. But salute to Colin Kaepernick. I like what you're doing. I wish that more athletes would take you know, such a rooted stance, and you know, because of the platform that they do have. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, sports
like surpasses. LeBron James, like people constantly asking LeBron James, speak on this, speak on that, mm-hmm. like. It's like, say something. Like,
because he has a major influence. LeBron James has a major influence.
Like, he's I don't know if he's the most powerful ball player right now, or the most popular right now, but he is incredibly popular, you know? And people are constantly saying, like, look, you have a platform. Like, speak on it. Speak mm-hmm. against police brutality, if nothing else. Mm-hmm. Like, that, I think that's what people are mainly asking. And as far as I know, he hasn't. Mm-hmm. And when you see somebody like Kaepernick do it, who I wouldn't say he has the same platform as LeBron.
Oh, of course not.
But even with the platform he does have, look at the impact it's made. Look at the ripples that have just gone across the entire nation, mm-hmm. probably the world, you know, from a single, second string.
He has a
mediocre.
Colin Kaepernick QB. Has a platform because of the sport that he plays, which NFL, it leads the ratings. Surpasses ratings for NBA games, obviously. And plus, there are only so few NFL games in the season. So you have to watch, you know, 16 games true. Versus 82 in basketball, you know.
But that's why I can't watch basketball.
LeBron James is just more of a celebrity than Colin Kaepernick. Like, I mean, LeBron James is, you know, is like King LeBron versus Colin Kaepernick. You know what I mean? So it's like there's no comparison as far as their star power.
Yeah.
But Colin Kaepernick has a major platform. You know, just it's football, you know. And plus, LeBron James has a lot more endorsements and things outside of basketball to be conscious of.
That's
and
true.
Taking political sides.
And so
whereas Colin Kaepernick, as being a second-string quarterback, probably doesn't have many. He doesn't have a Nike deal. He doesn't have a deal with Under Armour. Or
so
whatever.
He has less to lose.
He has less to lose for it.
I could do so. Well, I heard his jersey sales went up.
Well, yeah.
Like, because of this, like, people are buying the shit out of his jerseys all of a sudden.
Teams make a. Most of the percentage from jersey sales.
So he doesn't get any of that? Yeah.
I think it depends. Because, you know, the NFL has its own, like, is it like a constitution or something like that? You know, because you have 32 teams, 32 companies.
Unless we have somebody to just Google shit.
We're not sure about. What I mean? Like, yeah, we do need somebody to
Yeah, there's somebody sitting to Google,
like just hand us. We need, like, a projector screen up here. So, like, when we're talking about something, they can just Google it, pop it up on a projector screen. We can look up. Oh, yeah. Like,
Yeah,
it's like a reference board, you know. Where's Stephanie? Steph, get in.
All right, boom. Hey, Steph, we got a job for you now, yo.
Hey, boom. Like John Madden.
Boom. Shit. Like, yo, real talk, yo.
Oh, man. But yeah, salutes to Colin Kaepernick. And yo, you the man, my brother. Keep it up.
Yo, could we do a quick, like, shout out to, like, S2M and Livevolution, man?
Of course.
Like, last week, man, we didn't get to record last week, even though it was part of the plans, but it just didn't work out. But, man, we had a dope discussion, man.
Man, that was crazy.
With the Livevolution S2M crew,
you know,
man.
Like, honestly, we showed up at 4:30, right?
Yeah.
We didn't leave that
it was like a cookout.
Like 12 o'clock. I was like,
I had one veggie burger. But
what were we? What were we doing that whole time? Yo, you had like one veggie burger, like a whole bag of chips.
I ate a bag of chips and a veggie
like,
burger.
I'm not talking about like a little small bag. Just like the big ass bag of chips.
It was like because I had two different kinds of chips, you know? And it was like it was Lay's and
we definitely should have recorded, man. That was probably one of the more spirited discussions I've ever been a part of. You know, even though I myself wasn't saying much, it's just the discussions about. You know, just a flow of energy and, you know, just
creativity, man.
Creativity.
And going into how we go into our projects.
Like you're speaking about the war of art and, you know, and stuff like that, man. It's just
the war of art. Everybody, you have to pick that up. If you're in any creative endeavor, I'm plugging this book, even though I get no kind of money for
it. You are plugging that. They should sign you as an endorser. You do plug the
because
shit out of
I learned about it from the Joe Rogan show because he kept plugging it. And I was like, all right, let me check it out. And man, it literally blew my mind. And I saw a dude on the metro the other day reading the book. Mm-hmm. I'm just like, the book is good. If you have any creative endeavor whatsoever, you have to get that book, and you have to just follow it. Just follow the book, and it'll give you show you how much potential you have. But back to
check that S2M. I need to check that joint out. Definitely a shout out to S2M.
Matter of fact,
Evolution,
Steph Lover. It's not Steph Lover from the other show, but I just call Steph.
Yeah, you know, Steph. She know who we know. She know who we talking about.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying?
Definitely shout out to them, man. I can't wait till we, you know, I'm looking forward to possibly getting some off the ground together in the future. And incorporating the past and everything like that.
We might have, matter of fact, on a podcast. We're trying to get him on episode 10.
Man, we should have recorded last week.
Oh, man. That discussion was so good.
It was kind of like it was elevating, you know what I mean? And that would have just been such a good episode to put out. And, you know, plus we would have had so many more guests and so many more ideas flowing, you know. It was a cool time. It was a good time, man. Definitely shout out to them. Definitely. I think we should get the politicals out of the way first. Definitely. 9/11 anniversary is tomorrow. We'll never forget, honestly. I mean, that was a crazy time in our life. Juice, do you remember 9/11, though? I don't think we understood the true impact of what happened.
I was thinking about that earlier today when I was in the car. I was like, when that happened, I remember it being in class. And I remember hearing that something went down and the TV being on, right? And I remember seeing, like, a building fire. Like, we didn't see the initial explosion. But then later said, okay, everybody can go home. So we got off early. And I think I went home and played video games and then hung out.
I hung out with Chris Edwards, Dennis, Bill. Like, they just came over to the house the day of. We got out of school and they was like, there's no school, you know. So, I mean, we just hung out.
Hanging out. Like,
were we off school the whole week or just that next day?
I think it was just that day. And okay. Was it the next day? I don't remember.
I can't remember.
But I just remember definitely not understanding the significance of what happened.
Mm-hmm.
I remember that much. And then later, totally over time, you were just like, oh, you learned more and more about it. Like, we were young teens at that time.
I think that probably had something to do with the level of technology back then. I mean, it was 2001, but there was... Facebook wasn't as prevalent. It didn't exist. Yeah, exactly. So if 9/11 happened with Facebook, that jump would have been all over. The first thing people would have done is phone.
The first thing
in school, you'd have been like, what?
Oh, my God.
You know what I mean? Oh, snap. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The first thing you would have did was scroll Facebook. It would have been all over. Imagine if Facebook and Instagram and all that was around with that happening. You know how many people would have been up in that joint, you know, recording and
we had so many angles.
Way more video.
But somebody would have got all those Muslims cheering that Trump keep talking about, but nobody ever
seen. I remember seeing that video though. I do remember seeing that. But that was probably a select group of people. And they were
kind of saw that?
Yeah, I remember seeing that joint. Like they were you and celebrating. Trump. You know what I mean?
They were celebrating the towers falling?
I remember them seeing, they said they had saw it on like a news feed or something like that. And I remember seeing people cheering. Now, like we talk about previous casts, I don't trust anything the media tells us. So who knows if they were really celebrating towers falling or...
Were they Islamic? Like, were they Muslims?
Yeah, they looked like a Middle Eastern country they were in. I mean, it was just...
Oh, they
it was
weren't
just
like...
a video. It wasn't like, there was no... They weren't interviewing people and talking to people. You know what I mean? Like, it was just... I recall seeing a video like that, you know what I mean? But who knows what they were really talking about.
Dude, what I would give to have a picture of your mind right now, what you saw. Like, I was just like, what?
It just looked That's like crazy. They were celebrating to me. I don't know. It was so long ago, man. 2001 is 15 years ago. God damn, we're old, man.
Ah,
15
man.
Years. But, okay, so there was a video, obviously. A commercial went viral earlier in the week. Of a mattress shop in San Antonio, Texas called Miracle Mattress. And they hopefully will try to include a link to this. But they aired a offensive 9/11 ad where they were having a 9/11 sale and they had towers of mattresses stacked behind two gentlemen in the back and one lady in the foreground. And she's saying, there's a 9/11 sale, blah, blah, blah. And
She was like, twin prices, yeah. Twin prices. She said, mattresses, twin mattresses, twin prices, full mattresses, twin prices, king mattresses, twin prices.
So what the hell does twin prices even mean?
She might not have said that.
Well, I think she did. No, but what does that, like,
twin prices? Supposed to be like matching.
All one price?
Yeah, I think like everything was like the same price. Like,
you know, she had me.
I don't know what kind of sale
that is. She had me all the way up till there, you know? I mean... Because, I mean, honestly, I'd have been like, damn, if I needed a mattress, I might go in there, you know, up to that point, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm like, twin prices, as long as it's good, so I can get a king mattress, same as I can get a queen mattress, you know what I mean?
I guess so, maybe, right. Maybe that's what it was, probably higher price, but...
So all of a sudden, she says, you know, this is a 9/11 sale, and she waves her arms out, and she, you know, pretends to knock the two guys standing behind her back, and they fall into the tower of mattresses.
So there are two towers of mattresses. Mm-hmm. Like, that two towers of mattresses behind them. Oh, no, they fall into the mattresses. And Then what did she?
And the commercial, she said pretty much. She said, she was like, "Oh, we will never forget." And that was the end of the commercial.
Yeah, yeah. She's like, "Oh no, oh no," and then, "Oh, we will never forget."
And it was kind of satirical, and you know, it wasn't really meant to be taken seriously, obviously, but
too soon.
Yeah, it's, I mean, you know, regardless of your political stance, whether you think it was a coup or whatever, you think people died. You know what I mean?
A lot of people died.
That's an affront to...
People jumping out of windows.
It's too fresh in people's memory. That's like insulting Pearl Harbor 15 years after it happened. Or
Nobody does that.
You don't do that. You know what I mean? It's just, you know... So, yep. According to this article here on the Huffington Post, they said that the Miracle Mattress in San Antonio will close its doors indefinitely.
Is crazy.
That's fucked up.
Like, talk about a promotional video, an ad gone wrong. Yeah, ad was so fucked up.
And it was like a homegrown ad.
They shut the business down.
They shut the damn store down.
Trying to make money.
They said people was like threatening to boycott and blah, blah, blah. And I mean, come on.
They probably wasn't that big, but.
Who would, I mean, either cameraman. Okay, they got three people sitting there. Let's add a camera on a tripod, right? It's three people in commercial. Even the cameraman should have sat back and thought, yo, guys, this is probably a bad idea. He should have came up from behind the camera and be like, yo, I don't think we should do this commercial. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think we should put this out. You
like,
know
nobody thought to be like, hey, wait a minute. We should probably think about this.
Yeah, who thought that was a good idea? Like, Jesus. Like, come on, man.
Like, it's in our lifetime. Like, it wasn't that long ago.
It was funny, but then it was like...
It was funny.
Really?
It was sad.
That's my exact question to it when I seen it. Really? You know what I mean? Seriously? You know? All right.
Like, if it was for something, like, not as historically changing and historically pivotal as that moment, it would have been a good commercial. It would have been funny. Like, if, I don't know.
Maybe
like,
just not knock the guys back into the towers and then fall over.
It would have been funny.
You know
but that was a funny part. You know what I'm saying? Like,
it was, but it's just insensitive.
It was insensitive. But if it wasn't, like, if nine, like, if we completely turned the roles around, if 9/11... Nobody died, and they just knocked over some buildings, and people were like, oh, shit, they fucked those buildings up. And then she did that jump, and then the commercial was like that, and I'm like, oh, well, all right, that's pretty funny, and I'd flip right by that shit, not even thinking twice, but for God's sakes, a lot of people died.
I don't know, man. Honestly,
you can't, man.
San Antonio, Texas has a large Hispanic influence, I imagine. I mean, we went there 2 years ago to visit Chris. So we were there for like a week, man, but... Definitely a lot of Hispanics. So being so close to Mexico, I think we were like, seriously, I think we were like 100 miles, 150 miles from Mexico, from the Mexican border. You know what I mean? So it's right there, but it's still American soil. And the kind of the ruling thought of the land is, you know, American people, specifically, I would say white people, because they're still in control of a lot of the resources and the money.
Yeah.
So that kind of rules the, you know, they're the majority. And I don't care if you're American and you have any kind of pride, white, black, or whatever, you look at this commercial. It's funny, but on its face, but when you sit back after it's done.
There's a problem.
It's a problem because it's just, come on, man. You can't. It's too offensive. It's too offensive, man.
Like, it's just too many. Like, I always think about those people who jumped from the building. Like, I don't.
What's that crazy?
That's crazy.
Falling and, I mean, what are your thoughts?
From 50, 60 stories.
What's that person thinking?
I hope they passed out on the way down. Like, that's all I hope.
I heard you kind of do go into shock, like, after in a free fall like that. I mean, I don't know if it's true. I've never been skydiving or anything like that. But
man, like, I hope
from
it
the
is.
Time you decide, you know what? I'd rather jump out this window than burn to death inside this blazing hot room. You're right. That always sticks out of my mind, too. Those people falling, man. And people hanging out the windows. What are you thinking? When you're hanging out that window, 80 stories in the air, and you're looking down, and you're like, I'd rather be hanging out this window, something that would just be totally suicidal, than face this heat that's in this room right now, you know? Like, I can't stay in this room. Imagine, you know what sticks out of my mind, too, is, you know, and this is being in lieu of the anniversary of it being tomorrow, because we are recording this on September 10th. It's like the building's collapsing. And think about the people that were still inside that building.
Buildings as they went
while
down.
It's being pulverized and turned to dust. I mean, people's lives are being snuffed out instantly. You know, I mean, from the moment that building starts collapsing, I mean, there are probably people inside all those floors underneath. A soul is there, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
I'm not sure the exact amount of time you had between the planes hitting and collapsing, but I doubt that's enough time to get all those people out of that building. And then even think about the people that are on the ground level. who didn't think the building was actually going to collapse, that
who died that close, yeah,
the falling rubble. You know what I mean? You get crushed by a falling building. Like, you can't air a commercial like this and say we'll never forget. Like, it's too much. Funny. You're poking fun at it.
It's too much.
It's serious. That's crazy. You're right, man. That does always stick out my mind. Like,
it does, man. Like, that's the most.
What has to be going through your head to be hanging outside of a building? I'd rather hang outside this building and risk falling or jumping and dying on my own terms and being burned to death. I heard it was so hot in there, like, when you inhale the air, it sears your lungs, you know what I mean?
Because
it's like it's burning your lungs. It's literally, you're going to burn to death if you stay in here, you know what I mean?
And you can't be in there.
So like, what are your two options? You jump from 80 stories or you burn to death inside this building? Those are the only two options you have. You
at
have
some point, escape. It's probably fight or flight at that point. You just fucking move. You don't even think.
What would you do, honestly? You can't. You don't know until you be put in that situation.
Yeah, I can't even call it, but I might jump, man.
I mean, Jesus, shit. That's your only two options. You jump or you burn to death. It's like, you can't poke fun at that, man. It's too you soon. Can't do it. These people, honestly, whoever thought of this being a good idea, I don't know.
They didn't think it through. Like, they didn't think it through. I think that's all it really came down to. Like, they were having a, like, what you can see in this in the commercial, they were having a good time doing this. And maybe they're not so politically minded or so insensitive. They just didn't think about it. They didn't think what other people might feel about this. And they were just having a good time and cracking jokes. And what they did was they put their joke between them, their good time between them, out into the world, and that made it public. So, you know, if you ever had friends who would just, like, crack, like, people crack jokes but just between their friends, and it might not always be PC.
Like an inside joke, yeah.
Yeah, like an inside joke. It's not always PC. It's not always good. It's not something you would want anybody else to hear. Like, if somebody else walked by while you were cracking that joke to your friend, you'd be like, you would say it a little bit lower. Yeah. Right, but because they might find it offensive. So, what they did, where they fucked up, is they took that joke between them and they broadcasted that shit.
You got it right. They fucked up.
Yeah, they fucked up. Like, they
fucked up big time.
They shut the fucking company down. Jesus. Yeah, no more mattresses for them.
Yeah, that's bad, man. Like, I don't even know what they were thinking.
Yo, so, off topic, kind of random point, but is this related to 9/11, I guess, since the anniversary is coming up. And I saw it on the news that the Senate passed a bill allowing 9/11 victims and families of victims to sue Saudi Arabia. However that works.
How does that work?
I don't know how that works.
A family can't sue a country.
Maybe they can. I don't know.
But what kind of laws is Saudi Arabia beholden to, you know, as far as American law goes? Maybe it's an international thing. Maybe it's a...
I just heard that the reason they passed it was because...
Maybe it's like Interpol or something. I don't know.
I think it was like 14 of the 19 hijackers for the planes were from Saudi Arabia, actually. And so these are like Saudi Arabian terrorists. And somehow we ended up in Afghanistan and Iraq for 5 years.
Yeah. About 12 years now. But yeah, that's cool.
Well, you know, it's
cool. Having American influence in those countries.
It's cool.
But we got to secure that oil. I guess however that would work, I hope it works out for them. But how can you sue a country? I mean, Saudi Arabia is not a poor country.
No,
I think they're oil rich, pretty sure. So,
dude, you know, these cats, Saudi Arabian people, they come over this country. I heard something on the news the other week. So, it was a couple of months ago. They were talking about from Saudi Arabia, he's like a prince. He came over, he rented this like really big house, you know, like houses they shoot music videos in, like big, like expensive houses.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much wrecked the joint doing a party, like demolished the house.
Mm-hmm.
Went back to his country, and I was like, we're good. We're not gonna pay for it. We're not gonna fix anything. But they had the money. They have money to just come over and just have crazy cocaine parties, you know, and then just be out, and they can't do anything about it.
Yeah, those are like international laws. I mean, unless you want to go to war with, you know, Saudi Arabia or ruin any kind of international ties you have with Middle East, you can't, you know, hold a wealthy Saudi Arabian, you know, legally accountable for, you know, destroying anything. I mean,
They got too much money,
ramifications of that, you know what I mean? As far as, like, our relations in the Middle East.
Yeah.
So
you would have to go over there and make a big, big to do up in their government.
It's too many things. Too many and things to think about.
Political ties, like you said, man.
Those guys got money tied up in there. I've never been there, Saudi Arabia, but I'm pretty sure they have their problems like any other country. There, you got your upper class, you got your lower class.
Oh yeah.
I mean, yes, this guy came over here and rented this house and wrecked it, but not most of the Saudi Arabian population probably can't do that. You know what I mean?
No.
They're probably living day to day, taking care of their families. They don't give a damn about America. You know
talking
what I mean?
About those oil tycoons.
Like dude. America, what? Like, they don't know one place in America. Like, I don't know one place in Saudi Arabia. You know what I mean? They're probably thinking about, like, America, what? Like,
that's why I think Saudi and Arabia are two different places.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
I thought it was just Arabia.
Right, like, what is the capital of Saudi Arabia?
Saudi Arabia?
Exactly. So, like, you think about it, like, do Saudi Arabians know the capital of the United States? I would think that the average Saudi Arabian might not. Right. What do they probably give? What do they give a shit? You know what I mean?
They like probably got goats and they happy.
Yeah, they going day to day. They take care of themselves and living their life. You know, so it's like, yeah. I mean, whatever.
You ever seen the music?
Some Saudi Arabian mugs be rich though, man. Like,
what you ever say, like, seen? So they have this like Autobahn out in Saudi Arabia. I seen videos of this, where they just drive like expensive cars, crazy shit, like 90 miles an hour, just swerve it, hit it, and then they fucking flip. And the cars be rolling, like, and people be flying out of the cars. Just because they got so much money, they don't know what the fuck to do with it. So they just be killing themselves, man. Like, it's so much.
There was some Saudi Arabian dude who got, like, a diamond-encrusted car. But I don't like the paint job when the car had diamond speckles in that joint. This shit was ridiculous. I think it was, like, a Mercedes or something. I forget, man. I can't remember, but that shit was ridiculous. It was definitely a Middle Eastern cat who owned that joint.
You know that, man.
That shit was crazy. You know what I mean? But
think about that shit was too diamond encrusted.
That was too goddamn sparkly, dog. Think about when the sunlight, and that shit was in the showroom. Think about the sunlight hits that shit. You be like, God damn, I can't even look at that joint, you know?
Damn, that shit sounds sexy.
That shit would be sweet, like driving by, though. You know, you'd be sparkling. I'd be in that joint. Yeah, it's diamonds on there. That joint had diamonds on the door handle. Like, damn.
But, let me just hold that door handle.
Yep. But yeah, definitely remember 9/11. We'll never forget. Yeah, man. We'll remember, and our country will definitely forever be touched by that. You ever think that sometimes though the memory of 9/11 will kind of go down, maybe like a Pearl Harbor or something like that, where you remember that it happened. It's a historical fact, but you don't really understand the impact and the significance of it amongst that generation, you know what I mean? Like, so, you know,
I definitely think that's the case, or probably many things. I think history happens like that. It's just a passing of time. History is the revision of, or just the reassessing of past events, right? Mm-hmm. Dude, when you're sitting in the midst of it, like, it's day to day actions, like, it's small things, like Ferguson, Michael Brown, like all those things are historical events. Like, we're having our second civil rights movement right now. We're midst of it, you know. We're in the midst of all the riots that have happened. We're
and
in
being, the midst being of fueled it. By social media. I mean, thank goodness for social media. What would we do without social media? I mean, a lot of these things would have went unseen. Philando Castile,
they would have, man. Like, that's the crazy thing. Unseen.
We wouldn't have seen them.
They'd have wrote some false police report. He pulled a gun on them, and they killed everybody because they didn't know what else to do. Like, it'd have been something like that. And you know what's the craziest thing about this against me? Not to bring it back to the same police brutality topic, but it's just how many times cops have falsified reports, and nobody seems to say anything about it. Like, the whole Tamir Rice thing, like,
if you show up on a scene and you are the anointed authority on what happened at this scene, you can influence the outcome of it by telling people what happened or what didn't happen, you know?
Yeah, but... I mean,
that's not even a human... That's not even a cop fault. That's just a human characteristic. That's been done throughout history in any profession, in any... You can influence... I mean, if you can...
To, like, bend the truth to fit you. Yeah,
bend the truth to fit what you want. You know what I mean, it's an agenda.
Understood, yeah.
But yeah, you're right, man. It's like...
Like, how do they constantly get away with it? So it's a constant thing. Like, so what was the kid that was shot walking down the street in the middle of the freeway? I can't remember his name all of a sudden. But all of those cops in that scenario. So they shot this kid. He was unarmed. He was in the middle of the street walking away from the police. And one cop came up, he shot him, and he shot him 16 times while he was on the ground. Mm-hmm. And all the cops in that area, there were a bunch of cops in there, they all falsified reports in that regard. And they did end up convicting the cop. Mm-hmm. But it's like, so what happens to these guys? Because they lied under oath, mm-hmm. obviously. I don't know. It's one of the things that gets me.
You know,
I don't understand.
Everything boils back down to money, I believe. Like, in the end, everything is money. And, like, to make the kind of changes that people are talking about having, it requires a total overhaul of the system and the thought process that goes into creating a cop, you know, and like the parameters that you have to meet to become a cop, or, you know,
it would cost more to make police.
It would cost more to make a better police than just to push them out than we had, like the way we have now, you know what I mean? To give a policeman the proper training. Psychological and because a lot of this stuff is psychological. It's a difference between cultures, you know, like we've seen so many videos and lectures from people that say, if you're not from this area, how can you police people from this area? You know what I mean? If you're from uptown where there's a lot of money and you don't have a lot of issues of poverty, how can you go to an impoverished area and police it? You know, because then you're like, well, you know, you should be doing this. You shouldn't be doing that. And then this impoverished person is going to be like, how are you going to tell me what I shouldn't be doing? You don't know my day-to-day struggle. Exactly, you don't know what I'm doing to eat, what I'm doing to keep my power on, you know what I mean? Or anything
right.
like
what
that.
I'm doing just to survive. Like,
my situation is
me.
Different from yours. Exactly. So.
Yeah, man.
It's more expensive to do it, man. But it's crazy.
It's still not an excuse, though. But you're right, though. It is more expensive.
Oh, it is
we
not
need
excuse,
to fucking
though.
Figure it out. Maybe, you know what? They need to legalize marijuana. They legalize marijuana, bring in a whole nother set of income, whole nother set.
Say,
less
that's
reason.
That's where you want to move next?
That's a great segue right there.
Yeah, it is. Legalization of marijuana.
So it was an article I was looking at. It was written by The Root. And the title of the article is, Why Black People Are Being Left Out of the Weed Boom. And it was written in August. I just thought it was an interesting article. So it pretty much gives, just to summarize the parts of the article that I found most interesting. So it gives a summary of this guy... they give him the name Zulu, it's like, and he's a Maryland resident,
Nation.
And he calls himself an African herbalist, and he sells marijuana on the quote-unquote black market.
The black market.
Which, as we know, the black market is any market,
on the street,
you know what I'm saying, on the street, you know what I'm saying?
He sells on the street.
You know what I'm saying?
Like,
he just come through. He sells weed, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, we all know about the black market.
But it talks about this guy and how he's, this guy Zulu, how he's trying to, in D.C., marijuana is legalized in medicinal form, right? So, this guy Zulu, he's able to produce marijuana in different ways, in ways where he's able to... make ointments or oils or just sell it or just make edibles or sell it loosely, you know, however people need it for their ailments. And he works as a herbalist, right? So his main intention, he's not just a weed man, he's here to provide marijuana as a means of healing and helping people, right? And he was talking about how he finds it such a hard challenge to be able to break into the industry to become a legal vendor of marijuana. And he talks about some of the application fees. What does it say here? He said, just for an initial grower application fee is $2,000, or just a biennial grower license fee is $250,000. Now, I don't know what the biennial grower license fee means, but whatever it is, it's something that you need to be able to grow, a supply of marijuana. Well, I'm glad they wrote it, you know, because it's something that a lot of people talk about. Mm-hmm. Like, black people being the primary victims of a war on drugs. Like, what was it? I think it was one of Nixon's aides was caught in I won't say it was a press conference. It was a meeting, backdoor meeting, and he was recorded as saying, you know, yeah, we pretty much made these laws, and this is paraphrasing, but pretty much made these laws for hippies and black people, you know, which were in the 70s, in that era, those are the biggest contentions in the country. Like, hippies were protesting the war. You know, they were protesting a lot of the injustices that were happening societally, and the black people, that the civil rights were, I guess they were just more or less ending, but even still, they were still...
Oh, it was still going on.
Yeah, it was still going on.
It was fresh in people's
minds. It was fresh in people's minds, yeah, exactly. And, you know, and now, since black people have been victimized, you would I guess you would kind of want, you know, that maybe black people being already using, not even just recreationally, but medicinally, mm-hmm. but in having in having those people who are able to use this medicinally and provide and create products from marijuana medicinally, that maybe they could be able to get into a market to be able to sell it and provide it and maybe bring in some wealth for the black community, you know. Mm-hmm. But it's just like the government, the states, primarily the states, I would say, have already set up their guard fences, you know.
They've already muscled their way in. It's a drug game, baby.
It's a drug industry, man. Like,
it's legalized drug, and plus, you have to look at the economics of weed. You know, weed is a generally cheap drug, you know.
Yeah,
it's not as high end as, say,
grow it, literally.
It's not as high end as, say, prescription pills or heroin or cocaine or, you know what I mean?
You don't need to be
a chemist. I can take $20 and go get a little bag of weed and me and my five friends can smoke, you know what I mean, and chill out, you know. So it's generally seen as being used more by the black populace because, you know, a large percentage of us are more impoverished. So mm-hmm. we need a cheap form of a kind of a drug. But also, it's just the basic model of business is you muscle out the middleman, you muscle out the little man. That average street corner Zulu, even though I support him, and I would probably rather buy from Zulu if I knew him personally than go to any other store. That's why these corporations are scared of him, you know, because he's probably in touch with what his customers specifically want and what they, you know, that he's in tune with. You know, what the demand for them is because he's in the streets, he's living it. He
knows the people who need a particular help.
He knows the people.
And he can provide these particular medicines that I don't know how he gets his information, but let's say he has information that's passed down, you know, that he's able to provide these older ancient remedies to particular people who have these particular ailments. You know, I'm speculating here, but it's not absolutely impossible if you call yourself an herbalist. I'm sure you have knowledge in different herbs, as is your in your title, you know.
It's like, definitely, that's your job. It's definitely like he's definitely more in tune with, you know, than versus your well off white guy who's in control of this company or this herb shop. He doesn't go talk to the people. He's not among them. He doesn't live among them. He just doesn't know them. He doesn't connect with them like that. So they're scared of Zulu, first of all. Yeah. But I think a lot of times, like, you know, when you said black people are victimized, I kind of don't like that almost because I hate to always pull the victim card, even though we are victimized more so than a lot of other racists. I mean, you can come here and say that, you know, Asians, they come here, they create their own businesses. Middle Easterns come here, they create their own businesses. They're not denied business licenses, as is Zulu, who is a black guy who's trying to get his business license to start a business and being denied or having all these hurdles to jump over. But also,
he gets denied because of his address in the area he probably lives in.
They may have been racially profiled, but they were not physically oppressed as like black people who live in America were. You know what I mean? So it's a different dynamic. Like, the thought of an Asian in a white person's mind is probably different than the thought of a black person. It's like, you know, it's like a residual effect, like down through time, like we're better than these people because we enslaved them. And it's like, it's not a,
it's not outward, even conscious.
It's just an inert, innate thing that just is in their brains. It's like, you know, we make the world spin and blah, blah, blah. But, you know, the like, victim card, I kind of don't like that. But honestly, Zulu, he can't compete with corporate America.
No, he can't.
He can't. No, you cannot.
So he's gonna,
the corporate monster. Like, this shit is going to, you're going to be swallowed up. That's why the fees are so high. What's $250,000 to a wealthy businessman?
Nothing.
I shit that. You know what I mean? My car is worth that, you know? So it's like, yeah, to Zulu and to me and you and your average black
one thing
person,
they made a point, it was liquidable assets. So assets could be turned to cash.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not even you could put your house up if you had a house.
Yeah, you have to have the
like,
paper.
You got to have the paper.
You got to have the credit. You
got to
have the cash. And like, you know, he can't compete with the corporate monster that is, you know, American business. But, you know, I would definitely rather buy from this guy Zulu. He's more in touch, more personable. You're able to talk to him specifically. It's when you set up a business and you have people going to shop, it takes that personal kind of effect out of it, you know? So it's like, they're probably like, how can I help you today? What do you need? Okay, yeah, we have that over here. Where Zulu probably comes and sits down. Well, how were you feeling last week? You know, did the oil I had, did that work for you? You know, okay, well, how about we try this one? Because it's a new, you know, he gets more in tune with it. So they're definitely not going to let him in. They're not going to let him in. Why are they going to let him in? Because then if they let him in, they got to let the next guy in and the next guy. And then, you know, we just can't compete with these guys, you know, on the corporate level as far as financially, because they have.
So you gotta wonder, like, so is, do they raise,
which I think why a lot of times the sales of marijuana, even though there was a part in the article here that says well, I can't remember, but it said that so many states had legalized it just for medicinal use, and there were only 4 states that legalized it for recreational use. And I mean, honestly, Black people more or less are going to use this for recreational purposes.
I think most people
not even Black people, exactly. Thank you. Yeah. Correct me on that. Most people. I mean, you know, yes, people have, you know, it's good when you have cancer or other ailments or glaucoma,
medicinal seizures, purposes
to it. Yeah, pain reliever. But a lot of times people are using it for recreational reasons. Yeah, you know what I mean? People, like I'm sitting around, you know, I'm smoking a blunt, you know what I mean? I'm gonna pack this bowl. I'm gonna hit this bong or something. So
and be cool.
You know, I think that hurdle is gonna be hard to jump over, because then you're saying, where do we stop it? Where do we stop? Like, so if I can smoke marijuana recreationally, if they have like a smoking section at the park for cigarettes, are they gonna have a separate smoking section for marijuana? You know what I mean? Like, so where do we stop? Can I use cocaine recreationally? Can I use any other form of intoxicant?
So there's a school of thought.
There's kind of a double standard, because you can use alcohol recreationally.
Like, there's a school of thought that says that instead of criminalizing, or instead of making all these things illegally or illegal, all these drug substances illegal with criminal penalties, that it would be more productive and less costly for society, tax wise, mm-hmm. and just as a society, emotionally, I guess. Mm-hmm. If we simply regulated these products, like regulated cocaine, regulated marijuana, regulated heroin. You regulate these things, right? So people can get them and also have places where they can do them safely, do them in a monitored way. Do them in a regulated way. Like, maybe you'll need to have...
See, now, I don't agree with that. Because cocaine and heroin and all that goes beyond weed. Having used weed in the past, weed has no kind of a lasting effect to the point where you don't get... You kind of do get physically dependent on weed, but it's not as habit-forming as heroin. It's not as psychologically damaging as, you know, you're not... specifically shooting this thing into your vein or...
So it's the same thing with cigarettes, though. So you right, think about nicotine. Like, nicotine is definitely habit-forming and it's addictive.
It gets and into people your have, system and all that, just yeah, like heroin and
people
cocaine.
People have psychological and physiological reactions definitely to the psychological. Lack of it. So the thing
you,
about...
If you don't let a person have smoke cigarettes have their cigarette, they go, what? You
yeah,
know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah.
You better give my jack, you know what I mean?
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So here's the thing. So it's the same thing. Like, people addict to a lot of things. The same thing if you have an alcoholic, right,
mm-hmm.
who drinks alcohol all the time, and you take his alcohol away, he will die. If you take it, if you don't wean him off of it, if you don't mm-hmm. put him into a program yeah, you're right, to get yeah. him off of it, he will die because his body needs it. Like, so it's the same thing. So, right. So we have to provide... So that school of thought and... I kind of think that with some tweaks it could work. But if you could pass it to the right.
Do you personally want to live in a society where they say, okay, well, if you want to do heroin, you have to go to a specific place and go do it. You don't want people doing heroin.
So here's the thing.
Or even
so,
not even take it that far. Say cocaine or something. That's yeah, yeah. Stuff maybe that's not as bad.
I think that. So here's the thing. So when things become really available, like it's less of an attraction, right? Mm-hmm. So not as many people, if it's known what this will do to you and how bad it can be, then a lot of people won't use it, you know what I'm saying? And you'll have some who will, you know?
Mm-hmm.
But it won't be for, as long as it's regulated in the way that people can get it only through certain channels, or they're able to have a steady supply of it, right? So if you only have a steady supply of it, you won't be able to overdose. If you have a particular supply, right? I don't know all the details. So I'm gonna say it right now. I don't know all the details on how it will work out. But
having smoked weed before, but not having done, I've never done ecstasy or, you know, Vicodins or prescriptions or heroin or none of that. But I can say that I don't know. I personally don't want, you know, that other stuff being legalized. I think there's a clear and stark difference between weed and these other drugs, to the point where you can't regulate those. You just have to make those illegal. Because you don't, you know what I mean?
But do you want to criminalize people?
Do you want to walk your daughter down the street and this dude's over there with a crack pipe? You know what I mean? Like, he's sitting in the area where you smoke crack. You know? Like, he's doing it.
Wait. So what I'm saying is, I'm not saying like, yo, crack people sit here.
Yeah, you know, like, you just walking out here smoking crack. Like,
heroin shooters sit here. You know what I'm saying?
Well, he's like, over there tapping his arm and this and shit. Like, nah, I'm trying to find that vein.
You know what I'm saying? But you know I think it's about the availability.
Dude is asking you to borrow your belt. You know what I mean? Can I use your belt real quick, bro? Like, hell no, man. Get the hell away from me. Throw that belt around.
Hey, leave by your belt. Yeah, I forgot mine. But no, what I'm saying is that, like, so a lot of the what we identify as crackheads, people like itching and twitching on the corners.
Yeah. That's definitely what I was
like,
thinking.
These are people who aren't taking it in a regulated way. You know what I'm saying? They like, when people get it, they do it however they can get it, and they get it however they can do it. You know what I'm saying? Like, it's a lot of the overdoses that happen by people who they weren't able to get it for a while. They finally get some, and they fucking shoot it all at the same time, and they OD. It's because it's not regulated, because they have issues. So I've heard a story of a guy, right? I don't know. I've never met this guy. But that this guy, he works his job. In the afternoons, on his lunch break, he shoots up. He goes back to work. That's his day. He goes home. He feeds his kids. He does his normal life. You know what I'm saying? But what's the difference between that and smoking a cigarette, right?
Or even, like, smoking a blunt, or taking a drink.
You're like, a lot of people go home after a long day of work. They got to drink a shot of whiskey or a glass of wine to fucking be able to sleep.
You can drink a shot of whiskey or a glass of wine and not have the same kind of negative effects as heroin. I mean, I don't know. I've never done those.
Well, it depends on how much he's doing, right? That's the thing. Like, I've never done it.
To agree to disagree on this one.
I just don't know. Like, I'm saying right now, I don't know the details. But I think that it's better than criminalizing it, right? So I think criminalizing it just creates a problem. And it creates a system where more people are going to die from overdoses, where more people are going to be disadvantaged, and more people are going to be set out on the street, right? Where more people are going to be able to get a hold of this illegal substance. Mm-hmm. Like, criminalizing has never made it unavailable. It's never happened.
No.
It's never made this shit unavailable. So people are going to get it.
He's on the black market.
Right, yeah, exactly.
People are going to get it.
So you're going to have the same problem anyway. But I think that what that school of thought is arguing is that maybe you can have it in a way where, if people are going to do it anyway, have it to where we can regulate how they do it, right? Where the society, where they don't become pariahs. Where they can still go to the workforce. See, where they can't be outcasted.
You know how the American corporate monster is. And if you take that route with any other drug, I mean, look at weed.
I wouldn't be.
They're choking out the small man. Do you imagine if the corporate monster took over? Now, even though you have the thing, the sale of heroin and all these other legal drugs, they say that there's a quote-unquote war on crime, but do they really want to stop the sale of prescription drugs and these illegal drugs? I mean, it's a lot of money being generated. I mean, look at weed sales in Colorado. This article says that, another article I was reading said that they made about $33 million in weed sales in the state of Colorado last year. They said 3 million of it went to schools.
Yeah, dude. That's amazing.
That's a lot of money, man. Now think about it. The corporate monster took
over. Why we had that shit here in Virginia where they're already cutting fucking school funding?
But you also think about the corporate monster took over and they started influencing the manufacturing, the sale of heroin and cocaine and just all these other regulated drugs. You have to, some of that stuff is off the table. Like, that's the cocaine, all that's off the table as far as I'm concerned. A state like Colorado versus legalizing, because I found the part, it says recreational sales are allowed in 4 states: Colorado, Washington, Oregon, and Alaska. And this is according to this article on theroot.com. But I mean, think about the population in these states. Now, Colorado as a state probably doesn't have a large population, You know what I mean? There's a lot of wilderness there. You have population pockets, you know, where you have people that settled down in Denver. You know, you have so many millions. I mean, I'm pretty sure they have a population, but it's not as densely populated as an area like Maryland, where Zulu's right. from, or the Northern Virginia area. It's just everybody's packed in and crammed in, and, you know, you don't really want weed shops popping up all over the place, because then you're intoxicating the, I don't know, man. Colorado, do they have a lot of other income coming in? Do they have a lot of national, you know, products that they're pushing? How much money do they make as a state?
That's true.
To the point where this $33 million is a lot of fucking money.
That's a lot of money. But imagine you had that kind of money. Like, you're right. Colorado is a smaller, less populated area. Imagine you had that kind of money.
I think they're actually bigger. It's a big ass state if you look at Colorado. But
I mean, population wise,
it's like Yosemite is there or some shit. Isn't it part of Yosemite Park?
Is that Colorado? Yeah.
I don't know. I know they got like the Rockies and whatnot. Speaking of which, you know, everybody always talks about going to, while we're on the Colorado subject, everybody always talks about going to, like, Miami. We went to Miami and L.A. and all these sunny areas and everything for vacation. Wouldn't it be fucking awesome to go to, like, Colorado or something like that and, like, see the middle of the country, see, like, the mountain ranges and just the wilderness and, I mean, right? Wouldn't that be cool, man? I mean, you couldn't tell me yes. Yosemite Park wouldn't be freaking
tight. No, it'd be dope.
You're standing there on a freaking cliff looking down at this canyon, you know what I mean? It's just wilderness and trees. I mean, that would be beautiful. I would love to take a vacation out.
I think you'd have to be in the hiking or something, though.
Oh, yeah. I mean, definitely. I mean, you're not going to, there's no beach spots there. You know what I mean?
Like, not like a lot of drinking and walking around in the woods out there.
I'm pretty sure
they
have.
People would rather be walking and drinking on the beach.
But you'd have to be into, like, sightseeing and camping and
hiking. Yeah, definitely. Like, I'm all for that.
I'm pretty sure, like, downtown Denver has its bars and everything like that you could probably, you know. And it's probably within reasonable distance, man. We got to look into that, man. I would love to take a trip out to the middle of the country somewhere, man. If you bring this up to we call them the Nigs, our group of friends. you bring this up to the Nigs, they'll be like, what? You want to go to Colorado? Like,
so with the Bears?
Yeah, you know what I mean? Don't they got Bears in Colorado? I'm not going out that joint, dog.
Yo, Wildcats out that joint, man.
Yeah, man. That was crazy.
It's old Nigs.
I could not convince these dudes to go to Colorado, dog. They would never want to do it. Yeah, man, definitely. I mean, shit. It's funny. Like, the more you
the thought
about
is funny,
it,
though. You know, like, ask me that joke. Talk about
like, imagine me trying to talk.
Like,
B. Jones.
You trying to go see the geysers, nigga?
Imagine me trying to talk B. Jones and going to see geysers, though. He would not want to do that. Hey, B. Jones would not want to go out there. He'd be like, nigga, what?
Geysers.
This is funny.
I ain't worried about the squirting out that. You know,
fucking worried water,
about no water
geysers. I ain't worried about water squirting. That's exactly how that conversation would go. Oh man,
yo, shit though.
But yeah, man, they'll never let dudes like Zulu in. Just the game is too big. There's too much money at stake, and we don't have the financial firepower to last with these guys. You know.
So my friend,
and also they're scared of Zulu. They are. They're scared of him. They're scared of his potential, you know?
So how could we make that happen though? Like say us as a community or anybody.
Financial empowerment.
So how would
somebody needs to come behind Zulu and fund him. We were talking about LeBron James earlier, like a LeBron or Colin Kaepernick. You know, people say Colin Kaepernick is a second string. He's had a pretty good contract. I think he has like $10 million more left on his contract. You know what I mean? He has money.
But even if it's not like a single celebrity, I was thinking, mm-hmm. like, there's always a way to make things happen, right? You just have to step back and you know, ask the question, all right, what would need to happen to make this happen, right? So I'm thinking, like, crowdfunding, crowdsourcing mm-hmm. is a great, great tool that a lot of black people I don't think use very often. But imagine you were able to crowdfund, like, you're able to have black people somehow communicate with enough black people to crowdfund something like that. And all it will take is maybe $20 per person, or in a way where everybody will be able to push towards the
goal, yeah.
A particular goal, right? And of course there will be some benefit to everybody who would supply this. Like maybe they get a particular membership, whatever.
It would definitely crowdfunding, work. You just have to get people on the same page, which is hard enough for people in general, but even harder for... Well, no, I won't say hard for black people, because black people do a pretty good job.
I don't know, black people. Well, we can, yeah. But until it comes to money.
But our fellow black, or even white person. Yeah, like you said, when it comes to money.
When it comes to money, cats be like, I don't know. Like, I was down with you until you start asking mm-hmm. me for something.
But maybe that's like, because I'll show up. Like, the money is...
Well, I got to pay, though.
It's our essential thing that we, you know, that's, you know, you can't make it more... offensive statement than not paying somebody back some money you owe. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, I would definitely be with that.
But great things have come about through crowdfunding, crowdsourcing. Like many companies have been started, products have been made, technology has been funded. Maybe black people need to crowdfund more. Mm-hmm. Am I using the right word, crowdfund?
Crowdsource? It sounds right. I understand what you're talking about.
All right, cool. Yeah. You know what I mean.
Uh-huh. So it was like a GoFundMe or something like that.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Something like that. Like maybe Zulu could start a GoFundMe. Mm-hmm.
Might have already done it.
Maybe. I hope so. If so, then hey, it would be cool if it was in the article. I doubt it, because they should have put that on the article. So,
but like, I still don't think that $10. In the end, the corporate monster, man. I keep saying it. But it's,
we got to step outside of that, man.
We do. There are power in numbers. I mean, it would take a lot of people. There's
power in numbers, dude. Like, we have old white money, mm-hmm. but there's power in numbers.
And
everybody who buys from Walmart, if they bought from somebody else, Walmart wouldn't be the powerful anymore.
That's one thing we have, is the power of the dollar.
Power of the numbers.
Affect change people. And make change. It's all about convenience for people, though. Mm-hmm. You know, I think we were talking about this at Cass before. Like, it's a convenient to go to this mom and pop store up the street to support my, you know, fellow black person that who owns it that's 10 miles away, or is it more convenient for me to go to Walmart that's 5 miles away? You know what I mean? So, you know, it's all about like, but we, you know, there's definitely monetary power, man. That's really, that's probably the key factor we have, especially in corporate America, is how we spend our cash. You know, if you take that money out of Walmart, if all, say black people in this area really got offended by Walmart. They did something crazy. And we took all our money out of Walmart. You know how affected Walmart would be? You know what I mean? They would come on TV doing an official apology to GM Walmart. I mean.
Oh, yeah. They'll do.
That money, you take that money out and it's crazy. Hey,
washing your car and shit, man.
I mean, if we took all that same money and poured it into a case like Zulu's, it would just lift them up above the clouds. You know what I mean? And,
yeah.
You'd definitely be able to accomplish goal. Doesn't take goal. Much,
you know what I'm saying? Like, say you bought, I don't know, anything. Like, if we crowdfunded, we pulled our money into a pro-black organization. Like, black banks, man. Like, that's another thing. Like, there are black banks out there that need sponsoring, and they don't have the big name, you know? Because we're so used to rolling with
TD Bank.
Wells Fargo. Which I just saw an article on Facebook said that, like 5,300 people were fired for making a couple million false accounts for Wells Fargo, which I thought was interesting, but off topic, really.
So I mean, just real quick. So what do you mean false accounts? So
they made like 5,300 employees made up people in the Wells Fargo bank account.
Do they get? And I didn't read the article. Based upon how many accounts they start, or something like that. Why would they make up accounts? Are they adding money to the accounts?
You know, I don't know. I didn't read it. I just saw that
too, because I'm reminded of it. But I can't think either. I just saw it a second ago. Off topic.
Yeah, off topic. But interesting nonetheless. Mm-hmm. You know, but still, it's like maybe they get some kind of credit for it. Either way, like imagine like black people crowdfunding for their own banks. You know what I'm saying? And have black banks helping promote black people and black businesses.
See, then it's caught up in that corporate monster because it's like you start taking that money out.
Corporate monsters are liable.
They make it harder for those black businesses to start. They make it harder for that black bank to start. So you have to come back. You know what I mean? It's like it's a monopoly, you know, basically what it is. So, man, it's crazy. And that's exactly what they have on the weed game for speaking to Zulu in this article. Is they got a monopoly on it, man. They're trying to
lock it down. It's not in yet, though.
They're trying to lock it down.
But they get the hooks in.
Weed is, it was previously illegal, so people are so used to getting it in an illegal or quote-unquote black market fashion that it's no effect that if you set up a shop or I'm still going to get it, you know what I mean? I still know the guy up the street that got it, you know, so.
Here's an argument I heard back in the day, like why they would never, why people wouldn't buy weed legally. Is because like it wouldn't be good. It wouldn't be any good. Like the weed that was sold would be like shake. Like,
maybe it goes back to like the whole THC issue we were discussing before the
cast. If it's regulated, they're gonna sell the weakest shit, and you're not even gonna buzz off that shit. It's gonna be smoking dirt.
Could be. Definitely, yeah. You definitely wouldn't want all of it regulated, but I mean, I saw this interview with Snoop, and I think it was on the Breakfast Club a couple weeks ago, and he was saying that you know these guys have gotten so good at producing this weed now that, you know, the THC levels in your average bag of weed is, you know, maybe 40, 35 or 40, you know what I mean? You know, giving it a numerical value, and versus now when you can engineer a weed, you know, and create your own personal strain. These guys have gotten the THC levels up to 70 and 80, and I mean, you're just high. Jesus. It's like you're getting blinded because you're so damn high, you know what I mean?
Fucking transcending dimensions.
You don't want people selling stuff like that. So it does, I understand, I feel you, it does need to be regulated, just not cocaine and all that shit, and ecstasy and all that, because then you have to draw the line somewhere.
There's an argument to be made. I think there's an argument to be made. All I know is, all I want is people to do more research. Mm-hmm. I just want shit decriminalized. I don't think people... So one thing humanity has always ever done, right? Well, just a couple of things. People, humans, living creatures do, right? They fuck, they eat, they shit, find shit to do. And there's fucking drugs. Animals do drugs. Elephants get high. Fucking bugs get high. Bees get high. Like, everything will find something to intoxicate them.
You're kind of right. I never thought about it like that. Yeah.
Like, it's a natural thing to do. Like, what we do is we...
But you still have to limit what you can get high off of. Because some things are more damaging than others. Humans are
uniquely creative in these fucking endeavors, but still, you know, like...
High. We're more creative in the endeavor of getting high. Shit. Yeah, we get higher than a bee.
We get high in a muff.
Like at 80%.
You know what I'm saying? That's just crazy. But, like, still, man, like, it's part of our... I think it's part of our natural, you know, makeup. Like, mm-hmm. It's part of what makes us, like, humans. Like, how do we test things, you know? Like, the only way... Like, we're omnivorous, right? Mm-hmm. So, the only way humans are able to find food is in an evolutionary process. You know, you would have to test things.
Yeah, kill it.
And some try shit...
It, eat it.
Right, if you know what I'm saying? Die, you find some plants, you be like, mm-hmm. All right, chew on this joint for a while, and sometimes this shit might get you high. Mm-hmm. And if you survive it, you might come back for more.
You're fucking eating, drinking that peyote in that, my friend.
Bruh.
I heard that shit is crazy. Like, peyote? You know that shit's like made from like a... Isn't it like made from like the water and a cactus or something like that?
It's
like,
no, it's just these buttons, mm-hmm. like these little like flower bulbs mm-hmm. on a cactus. And that you eat, and then you eat those, and it just fucking launches your ass. I heard them
jokes is crazy.
Dude, you ever read Carlos Castaneda? Uh-huh. So Carlos Castaneda he's a Yaqui, which is the tribe of people in Mexico who, that was their ritual, like, it was their spiritual ritual to take peyote. Mm-hmm. So Carlos Castaneda was like a shaman. The story is from the perspective of a guy who goes to train under him, mm-hmm. And he's given these peyote buttons, and he takes them. Like, the trips he goes on in that book are so crazy. Like, he turns into crows. Mm-hmm. He's in that joint running, talking to spirits. Like, he's experiencing every... Some people say that, like, psychedelics and hallucinogens mm-hmm. are, like, some of the real base roots of religion. And that's how their religions are based mm-hmm. off of. Right? So they take it, I guess, ritually or religiously. They take it in a spiritual sense. Carlos Castaneda, I forgot what the book was called, but he's a writer, and it's a really good book.
Hey, he was probably on some mean trips in that journey.
Bruh, like, he was talking so many times about how he woke up. It was one joke, he woke up in, like, somebody else's house, and he was naked. And he was talking about how he had to run out the house through the desert to get back to... Yo, I read that joke. I was like, what the
fuck? That'd be some scary shit. No, I wake up naked. I'm like, oh my God, where the fuck am I?
But he was like a crow in that mm-hmm. joke. So he didn't need no clothes. It was like, he was flying. He was flying. He
turned into a crow and flew.
He was out in the wilderness, just running around. Oh, bro.
No, he was tripping, dog. If I seen a dude like that on the streets, I'd be like, hey, bro, sit down, man. Let's get you some help, man. Get you a bottle of water or something.
Better than me. I'd watch him go by.
Yeah, man. I guess that about does it for our marijuana topic.
Marijuana.
What do you want to do next? For this superhero drama, Black Lightning. Yeah.
Black Lightning is a superhero. It's a DC superhero from, like, back in the day.
Is he like Static Shock?
He is kind of like Static Shock. Yeah. Actually, he's like...
I used to read a couple of Static Shock comics back then.
So I don't know. They're not like related or anything. Mm-hmm. He's got like a lot of power in that. He's electricity and stuff like that. Yeah. So he's I've seen recently he had a they were trying to start a cartoon with him, and he's like a retired. So his whole thing is he's a retired superhero. Mm-hmm. So he's not like old, but he's like a father. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? He's like, all right, I'm done with the superhero game. So he just works, and he's got daughters, you know, and. His whole thing is that he just he doesn't really want to get back in the superhero game, but he's kind of forced into it. Pretty much the article I found, HBR Media, article is called Amara Brock Akil's Superhero Drama Black Lightning Lands at Fox. So there have been talks about having this Black Lightning show on TV, and it looks like Fox landed the deal and got Amara Brock Akil, who did some other work on BET, working with Sanaa Lathan on a show called Being Mary Jane on BET, and Documenting Love on ABC. So she's done work before, and looks like she's going to be giving the be the head writer on this show. And it's just really interesting, a really interesting kind of aspect to bring to the media. Like, you know, we have Netflix and Luke Cage is coming out, and the hype surrounding that, and then we have the Marvel Black Panther movie coming out.
Wait, backtrack. Is there hype surrounding Luke Cage? Because I've never personally heard of this guy before.
Bro, there's hype surrounding Luke Cage. Like, you know, Tribe Quest. Ali Shaheed is doing the soundtrack for Netflix
series. That might be kind of dope.
So that's kind of, it's hype. Like, there's hype, man, and people are talking about it. Like, it's people. At least I'm waiting in the circle, the nerd circles I'm walking. I'm in or waiting for it. So I think it's gonna be a good show. So this is just kind of like, it was like DC is trying to get a piece of this, and I know people have been asking for a long time. Why don't we ever do a Static Shock movie? Static Shock.
Static Shock would be kind of awesome.
We would need a young, black, dreadlocked superhero kid.
And also, it just depends on the level of realism they're trying to add to it. Like, we don't want it to be... The movie needs to be well-funded to be enjoyable. And we just don't want it to be kind of, like, so satirical to the point where, like, it's kind of laughable what they're doing, you know?
No, yeah.
I think, honestly, I haven't watched it yet, but Netflix does a really good job with Daredevil, man. Like, I watched a couple scenes on YouTube, and I gotta check out the series, man, because, like, the level of realism and the grittiness to it, it just adds to the show, and it's like, man, this is just it's a cool show. It keeps you interested, and the action is off the chains.
Like, the story is deep. It's long-form storytelling, so it's telling the story over, like, the entire series. Mm-hmm. But he goes in here, and he's literally a blind dude fighting. Mm-hmm. But he's badass.
Yeah, and
but at the same time, he's getting his ass whooped.
The level of grittiness and the realness to the fight scenes and the action scenes, just it caught me, and I was like, man, looks like a really good show that they're not really trying to skimp on. Like, they don't have to have a lot of CGI and blow the budget, but they add a level of grittiness to the choreography that draws you into that world, you know? And that's my worry with this right here, because Black Lightning, first of all, I've never heard of Black Lightning. It's never been so prevalent in my thought process, and like we were talking before the cast, we probably came in like one of the last generations to actually have like paper comic books, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
You remember that feeling of sliding a paper comic book out of the sleeve, and you know what I mean, and like you're cracking open, flipping through it and reading it, and it, remember hating getting to the last page?
You're like, yeah,
damn it, now I gotta wait till next month, you know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
dude,
it's like, damn.
Well, here's the thing, so it's honestly like that era is not over. Like, I got some new comics over there.
It's not. Like, there's a comic store over across
right
from,
over in the corner right there.
It's a comic store over across besides Boston Market over there by Old Country Buffet and whatnot.
Yeah. Oh, in the corner.
Yeah.
Where Gators used to be, right?
I never noticed that, John. I was like, it's a comic book store.
That used to be
on
go to. It's still there.
Yeah, it's still there.
Oh, you know, good.
Some
I haven't been there for years, and I thought they might have been closed.
That's my worry with this show, though, because they list shows that also come on the CW, which is another channel. This is Fox, right? Yeah, so they come on the CW, which they're probably all under the same umbrella company.
Yeah.
So it's probably the same deal. But they list shows like...
Supergirl,
the Arrow, the Flash, Supergirl.
So
I don't watch any of those shows.
I don't know what
so
Legends
is this
of
show
going to
be
is
in the same vein as, like, I'm happy that they're having another black lead character. I think that's important. I would imagine that maybe even a lot of white people want to see a little more diversity in superheroes, right?
Yeah,
I mean, let's think about how well the Black Panther was received in Civil War. I mean, this is an awesome character. Like, superheroes, they know no bounds. Like, you can be black, white, Hispanic.
Yeah, it's all about the character, the person.
The character and the storytelling.
Right, yeah, and their strengths and their weaknesses. Like, that's one thing people love about superheroes is, like, even with their powers, you end up finding out that they're as weak as we are emotionally or in our own, like, human way. Like, we have the same weaknesses, the same hang-ups, you know, even though they're super. That's what makes great storytelling, you know?
So, I'm kind of worried about Black Lightning. First of all, I don't know much about her. And I don't hang out. I'm not the biggest nerd on the planet that I know, but I've never followed Black Lightning. If they add a level of grittiness and realness to it, like they keep it in that Daredevil vein where you can relate to it. And I'm an action buff myself. I'm an action junkie. So I love action scenes and choreography, and I love just the fast pacedness part of movies or shows, which Daredevil exceeds that. As long as they do something like that, maybe I could give this show a chance. But if it's anything like a Supergirl or, you know, So
the people who watch Flash and Arrow, and the people watch that, they love it. Like, you ever watch Smallville?
They do. These shows
I used to watch Smallville. And I used to like Smallville.
Smallville was whack. I did watch that shit. I did used to watch Lois and Clark back
then. That
shit
was whack in the Smallville, dude.
Lois and Clark was cool.
Come on, dude.
Well, I mean, you have to think about the time. Like, Lois and Clark came out like 10 years before. Yeah. So
that was weak in the Smallville.
Lois and Clark was the shit, though. You know what I mean? Come on, man. That joke was the shit. I used to watch that, though.
Man,
I used to watch Hercules and Xena and shit.
He had no muscles at all, yo.
He had no muscles. He's Superman, damn it. All right, I don't have to work out.
Yo, I see this article people are getting pissy about. It was an article. It was a meme. Mm-hmm. And they're talking about how, like, in real life, Superman would probably be a fat dude.
Because
he can't work out. But how do you work out if you could lift the planet? How do you work out?
His metabolism is so high. You have to figure he does burn off a lot of calories and everything like that, so he burns all that shit off.
But that doesn't equal muscle.
Superman, but he doesn't gain any weight, you know what I mean?
He would have to eat constantly if Superman, his metabolism was like that.
How much weights can you lift to get buffed out if you're Superman?
You need a couple moons.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, you'd have to go lift some mountains or some shit. That is a good question. Yo, that's a topic for the next podcast. You know how the fuck does Superman get buffed and lift weights? Because what exactly can he do? He can't just
He had to just be a regular dude.
He can't go to World's Gym and lift weights, you know what I mean, and work out, right?
No, like, hell no. Like, what
does he do?
And do what?
To cut himself out. He just come pre-cut? He's pre-cut? Already, I guess. I don't know.
They got, like, Cavill and Superman and the Man of Steel. He's buff as shit. Yeah, I like him too, man. A lot of people hate, but he's so buff. I'm like, all right, he's swole as shit. That's a good Superman.
Mm-hmm. What the fuck does he go lift?
Does he swim?
does he go run on the treadmill? Can Superman sweat?
Exactly. How does he sweat, son?
These are some philosophical, fundamental questions that we need answered.
Can't sweat?
Yeah, can he sweat?
Like, a treadmill don't go as fast as he needed to go.
Like, can Superman run on the treadmill?
Hell no.
You're right. Superman would probably be fat. Where did you hear this from?
It was a meme, I see.
Yo, you're changing my thought about Superman, because he probably would be a fat dude.
It's like, even if he has a super metabolism, he would have to eat constantly.
He could eat a bunch of food. Can Superman get full?
I don't know.
I don't know either. This is just mind-boggling.
How does
this
shit he eat sustain him?
I don't know. Like, wait a minute. Okay. Hey, but this is changing the Superman game here, though. Because I don't know. Man. I don't know these answers.
But yo, just give Black Lightning a chance, man.
I think it might be all right.
We'll see.
Yo, while we're
if it's on Netflix, I'll watch it.
While we're in the whole superhero vein, Suicide Squad came out, what was it, about a month ago now, probably? We're so late. We haven't recorded in a month.
Super late. But, yo.
But anyway, what'd you think about Suicide Squad, man?
I thought it was okay, man. Like, it wasn't as bad as people thought.
I liked it. Honestly, I don't think, for the most part, when I seen on IMDb, there weren't a lot of people, general fans and everything, who went and saw it that didn't like it. It was a lot of the critics who didn't like it. Maybe because of the structure of the story and everything like that. But I thought, just as an overall movie, I thought it was entertaining.
I guess there were a couple holes. Of course there were.
It's DC, you know. They're not as polished as Marvel. I mean, look at this last movie Marvel did. Civil War was a masterpiece. Was there one time you were bored in that movie? Was there one conversation where you're like, I don't care, you know?
And Suicide Squad?
In Civil War.
Oh, Civil War? No, hell no.
It's a masterpiece. It's a masterpiece, though.
Yeah,
that was
wonderful.
You can't make a superhero action movie any better than that. It was perfect. It was just perfect. But they perfected that art of making superhero movies. I like Suicide Squad, man. I almost said loved. There were a couple holes. I would say I would go as far as say I loved it. I thought it was good. I would sit down and watch it again without being, you know, willingly. I would probably buy the DVD, you know.
Yeah, I'll watch it again, definitely. I wouldn't say I loved it. Like, I thought it was good. I thought it was a good movie. It was entertaining. Like, I felt okay at the end. I didn't feel like I missed anything. I didn't feel like
anything was missing. Whereas Batman vs. Superman, you felt unsatisfied at the end. You were like...
Yeah, I was like, all right, that was a little... It was mostly... A little empty. Luthor got me. Eisenberg.
Yeah, it's so wacky. And it's like, oh, God.
Jesus.
But Suicide Squad, man, it had some cool visuals. The coloring and everything was cool. I love the Joker, man.
Yeah,
I
love that, dude. I love you like that
interpretation
you like
of the that Joker? Joke? Man.
Oh,
that
man.
That dude was fucking cool, man. I mean, just...
Ha, ha, ha.
Yeah, like that slow... It was like a totally different take than Heath Ledger.
Yeah.
And of course, you know, after I saw the movie, I went and watched a bunch of reviews, and people were comparing Heath Ledger's Joker versus Jared Leto.
It wasn't the same.
It's not the same.
Not even close.
But also, Jared Leto didn't have as long of a movie as Heath Ledger's Joker did. No. Heath Ledger Joker, I love that shit, man. Like,
yeah.
All three Joker. Movie versions of the Joker we've seen have been totally different. Like, even from Jack Nicholson to Heath Ledger, now to Jared Leto, they've all been different. Like, Jack Nicholson was the first. He was a classic, you know?
Yeah.
And you think about it, like, were we talking about this last week? I don't know if it was me and you. Joker was a gangster. You know what I mean? Like, even back to the Jack Nicholson joint, he was a gangster.
He always had his henchmen.
He was working for a kingpin before then, you know?
Yeah.
Whereas, like, Heath Ledger was more of like a psycho, you know? Like, he probably
he was an anarchist.
He had
an
his henchmen.
He just wanted to destroy and break systems of.
And Jared Leto's brought it back around to, I think, to Jack Nicholson Joker, where he's a gangster, dog. He walked in that joint, tatted out.
Yo, he had his
gun chains on. You know what I mean? He had chains.
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, he has a grill.
Yeah,
Joker
he had
a
grill.
It's like, yo, that joke was hard. Like,
he was tatted up.
This
man.
Version of the Joker was just too cool, man. He had that little mouth tattoo thing he kept putting over his face, and like,
yo.
He had the stack of cars tattooed on the side of his neck. I was like, yo, this dude whoop your ass.
You know what
I mean? Like, I'm not looking at Heath Ledger's Joker like he'll whoop your ass. Like Heath Ledger's
Joker
was
like a maniacal
crazy,
genius,
but. Jared Leto's Joker coming at you and smack you with a pistol whip you in that joint. You know what I mean? Like I was scared of this dude. It was time when he was on the screen where I was like, what is he going to do? You
right.
When
he was a common, I didn't know what the fuck. I was
like,
nervous, son.
He's like Harley. He called Harley over there and Harley sits on.
Yeah. I was like, oh shit, dude, get out. I was like, run.
run.
No.
Yo, remember he was talking to the guard at the prison and he made him kiss his pinky ring and shit?
Oh, yeah.
When he said, he's like, I know you meant that. Or something like that. You know, like, because he sat on his lap. Like, but you didn't know what he was going to do before that. Like,
that was a good
he held
joke,
his
man.
Hand out. He was like, okay.
Yo,
like,
dude. But he was still kind of fucking crazy and fucked up because he even drove the fucking car.
Mm-hmm.
He drove the car right off the bridge. Harley went through the windshield.
Wasn't that a cool visual, though, where Batman's like, he dives into the water and Harley's like laid out on the hood and then. Batman swims up to her and she just pops up like she's about to hit him and he punches her underwater and knocks her back out. Like it was cool.
Yeah, that was good.
That
right?
movie had some good parts to it. It did, man. It wasn't as superhero-y as I would have liked. The only really
it was cool.
Like they got Boomerang. The hell was he doing in there? You know what I mean? Why was he even there? Like his powers,
there.
He throws a boomerang. Is he a metahuman?
No, he's Captain Boomerang.
Does he have anything to like?
I've seen him in comic books before. He's literally just that.
Just throws Boomerang.
He's not even as funny. He's not as funny, but he's still kind of quirky.
I thought his character was pointless. I liked Will Smith, even though I wish we would have saw him do a little more.
Right, so that's my one thing. Like, we saw him shoot that one angle when he was taking out that one bad guy.
In the very
beginning. But I feel like when he was fighting those zombie. Putty
with
things.
All the cars and everything, yeah. They did like putties, didn't they?
Right, yeah. So I felt like if he was fighting those things, he could have hit some, maybe shot a bullet off a corner and hit one on the side. Or
did something kind of cool
like,
to show name, his
Yeah, you're dead
prowess.
Shot. Like, you could hit everything. Mm-hmm. Like, it doesn't matter. Like,
you could shoot it off the
like,
wall.
Don't just shoot in straight lines.
Yeah.
You know? Give me something cool. You know?
Yeah.
Shoot under your leg. You know? Shoot
I thought that was
back.
A little bit underwhelming there.
Yeah, like when he had that one scene, like, it was cool. Mm-hmm. He was taking everybody out when everybody was running. But still, you could have, I don't know, you could have done some other cool
done
stuff.
Something just a little bit cool, eh? But to me, honestly, he carried the movie. Him,
he did.
Joker, and Margot Robbie, or whoever played
Harley Quinn,
they carried the movie. I did like the fire guy at the end, though.
He made
like
that too.
He surprised
he came
me.
Through at the
I
end.
Was like, holy shit. Like, you know, I was kind of mad he died. Like, he's dead. He was a vital member to the Suicide Squad. He was vital. Like, he was probably the strongest guy on the Suicide Squad.
He was,
squad.
Man.
So
like he was the only one that could hold down against that big.
You needed him. The hell that guy was. They should have been mad that he died. Yeah. But yeah, man. Overall, it was a good movie. I love the bad guys. I thought what was the witch name?
Enchantress.
I thought she was kind of cool, except for that little stupid dancing thing.
Dude, I'm glad somebody else saw that. Mm-hmm. Jonathan, me. I was like, that's just really awkward.
Yeah, it was. Please. She's standing there, just you just should come
gyrating.
Yeah, it's like
why it's not even gyrating because it wasn't smooth. It was just like she was twitching. She was
and
cold.
Even before she turned into that, I liked the old Enchantress. Yeah, she looked kind of rugged and more witchy. She looked more like a witch, like,
dark and evil and.
What's she called? The Ring? Remember that girl used to climb out the well and come through the TV?
Oh, yeah.
She looked kind of like that, you know? Yeah, mm-hmm. It looked primal and just ancient. And remember and that scene where... Remember when they had her in a meeting at the very beginning? She's in there, like, talking about the briefcase or something, and then the hand comes out and wraps around her hand.
Flips around.
That shit was scary. That was a scary little part right there, you know?
That was dope, man.
It was. That shit was dope. I was like, oh,
and then
that?
She turned into that weird wiggly lady.
Yeah, man. And it was like,
she went back, though, and she whipped the ass some more.
I liked her brother. When he first formed, I was like, holy shit, they going for broke on this bad guy. This bad guy was cool. He was cooler than Doomsday to me. I liked him better than Doomsday. And he probably wasn't as strong as Doomsday if you're trying to get nerdy with it and talk about strength levels and stuff like that. But I thought him visually was cooler than Doomsday. The way he was shooting that plastic spiky stuff all over the place.
That was cool.
And just leaving.
I just didn't understand him. Like, I didn't understand his motivation. I didn't the motivation of that guy. Like, Enchantress, I get she had, like, a revenge. She wanted a heart back, blah, blah, blah. But that thing was really... I didn't follow it, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was there. It was... I guess it was cool to have something for them to fight against. Mm-hmm. I wish they'd bring El Diablo back and have him fight somebody else in the next one. Like, don't kill El Diablo. Just bring him back. Can we have that? Because I feel like him dying against that thing was kind of pointless. Because that guy was just a pawn. It seemed like he.
And I thought a lot of the humor in the movie kind of fell a little bit flat. Although there were some funny parts, but a lot of the jokes they wanted you to laugh at, you just kind of didn't. Versus Marvel, like Jesus Christ! Remember in Civil War when the Winter Soldier's sitting behind Brooks in the car? He's like, "Can you leave your seat up?" He's like, "No,
no."
Yeah, that was perfect. The shit was just funny, you know. And then like. Tony Stark kills it. He's funny in every Marvel movie he's in. Yeah. His comedic timing is just on point with his lines and stuff like that. So
snarky bastard.
Yeah, he's just snarky and stuck up. And like you, but you know, one thing with Civil War is like you see his evolution. Like you see the change in Tony Stark from the first Iron Man all the way through Civil War. Like he flew through that portal and he saw
what was on the other side and how. Big of a problem they have.
He made Ultron, and you know what I mean? So, like, he sees that they do need to be regulated. Civil War was such a good movie.
It was, man.
Because you could see both sides. You could see, like, Captain America's like, well, what if there's somewhere we need to go, and they don't let us? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Or, you know, like, you see both sides. You're like, yo, you do need to be regulated. But I see what Captain America's saying. Like, you know, it's with agendas, and people, agendas change. And that was such a good fucking movie.
It was, man.
God
it
damn
was,
it. We got to stop talking about Civil War, but I liked I like Suicide Squad overall, man. So it was one thing I want out, I didn't like how they went back to jail at the end. What the hell? So they go back to jail. I understand that Suicide Squad are the bad guys, but...
Well, this is the next mission. Like, that's how they keep them. They can't, like, let them go.
I like how the Joker broke in and busted out Harley Quinn at the end. The Joker is so cool with that
cool
joke. I cannot wait to see... I heard this theory that what if, you know, because we saw in Batman vs. Superman. Now, this is... projecting to the future. I don't know. This is just fanboy shit. Like, what if, you know how we saw the Wayne Manor destroyed, right? So that goes in with the whole kind of killing joke, you know, when Jason Todd got killed and the Red Hood and everything like that. So what if this incarnation of the Joker is Jason Todd? Remember how, what was it, Batman
like
Beyond?
Like
remember,
Jason Todd becomes
Wasn't
Joker?
There a Batman Beyond movie where Jason Todd or the Joker or somebody was... He was the Joker. Like, the Joker, like, inserted his DNA into Jason Todd or something like that. And he would physically transform into the Joker. So, like, the Joker is a part of his DNA. You know what I mean?
Oh, I hadn't seen that one.
It's crazy. Like, this is a whole fan theory. Like, because that's why this Joker is so much different and more cool and more hip
and
more
young,
in tune
and
younger.
Young.
You know what I mean?
Because Batman's old in this new one.
Exactly. He's old in that universe. He's an older guy. So, it's like, what if he is, like... Wouldn't it be cool to have, like, a Joker who is just as crazy and nutty as a Joker and psycho, but has the fighting skills of Batman? You know what I mean? The Joker, it was just cool. I was like, oh, that would be kind of tight.
I don't know, though. Like, I kind of like Joker not being the hand-to-hand guy. I like Joker being, like, he can fight if he needs to, but at the same time, he's a mastermind and a mad hatter.
Yeah,
like,
he's just a psycho. I loved it. I like Joker, Will Smith, and Marco Robbie were the best parts of this movie. Yeah. And it was a cool movie.
She was a good Harley Quinn. I liked her as Harley Quinn. So there was one more thing that kind of threw me off. And it was how they tied, how all of a sudden the team meant so much to them at the end of the movie.
Yeah, I heard that
like,
too.
It was a little weird. Like, what was that meme I sent you? Like, it was the album, like, you guys are family. And then Will Smith was like, dude, I met you like 6 hours
ago.
Yeah,
you know what I mean?
He was saying, like, I just met you. Like, I don't know you. Harley Quinn came back after Joker was allegedly killed in a helicopter crash. I was like, I guess he could have survived that, John. Maybe you want to go check. But she went right back over there. It was like,
I heard that they should have had like a mission before the main mission. Something to kind of galvanize them and draw them together. And you can see where their closest, their bond came from. Like, okay, yeah, this dude's kind of cool. You know, like, he's really got my back or something like that. That could have helped. But I liked it overall, man. I thought it was a good looking movie. Thought it was cool. If they came out with a Suicide Squad 2, I'd go see it. I'd go pay money to go to the movie theaters to see it.
Yeah, I'd watch it. Definitely, speaking of which, I still never saw the Apocalypse X-Men movie.
Mm-hmm. I haven't either. I kind of forgot that it came out. I heard it was terrible. Hey, to put it in President Obama terms, let me be clear. Yo, what comedian did I hear doing his voice? Oh, man, it was some voice impersonator. Yeah, he was doing Obama's voice. He said, let me be clear. You know what I mean? Like the way he sounded just like him too. Yeah, that was funny.
It was it.
But all right. So, in conclusion for this cast, we have a list here that I got from. Oh God, I can't even see the name of the site. Anyway, it doesn't matter. It's a article that says 17 MCU, which is short for Marvel Cinematic Universe, Phase 4 rumors that we hope are true. And I guess are we in phase 3 or phase 4? I guess it's always hard for me to break down. Marvel has done such a good job at coming out with these movies, man. You have to think phase 1 was probably the first Iron Man. Think about how different the first Iron Man was from how long ago the first Iron Man was to Civil War.
I don't remember Iron Man 2.
Then nobody does. Even Iron Man 3. That's what Iron Man 2, I think, is when they had Whiplash. And Iron Man 3 was when they had to do Kendrick. Yeah. All in or whatever, but those jumps were kind of wacky. They weren't as good as the first Iron Man.
Yeah, first one made it.
But I mean, even think about like Captain America's the very first Captain America. Think about the first Thor movie. Long ago that shit came out. They've been planning this shit all the way up till now. It's like 10 years of making movies that they've just been planning and dropping consistently. You know, every year they drop a movie. You know, all the way up to the conclusion of not the conclusion, but the latest, the Civil War. And
Infinity is next, dude.
You have to think that jump's gonna be so cool. It's gone. Remember at the end of Avengers: The Civil War where what's his name came in and slid his hand in the gauntlet and was like, I'll just do it myself.
Oh, Thanos?
Thanos, yeah. Was that Civil War or was that Avengers Age of Ultron? I think it was Age of Ultron.
Yeah, he was in Age of Ultron at the end.
Because he was in Guardians of the Galaxy and he was in Avengers Age of Ultron. I heard Guardians of the Galaxy are supposed to be in the next Avengers movie. That's what I heard. That's what I read the article or something. Yeah, that'd be
cool. Yeah, because they need the gems, and they have one of the gems.
They're tying everything in. That's what I'm saying. Like, Thanos was in that movie, and he was in The Avengers. So it's like they're tying all this shit together. Like, it's so cool, man.
This is crazy.
It's so cool.
I'm like, so hyped right now.
What the fuck is DC doing?
Can't wait. They're right, so rushing. That's what they're doing.
We're going to run through this list real quick, just for shits and giggles, just because it's the end of the cast, and we haven't recorded in a month and a half. How long have we been going for, man? I haven't asked my... traditional question.
We're at 1 hour and 43. So.
Oh my God! Like, how can we? You know, if anybody's listening to this and they think that our casts are too long, let us know, because you know we've heard that long casts can be kind of, you know, a little bit of a bummer sometimes. But we'll see. I enjoy them, and hopefully anybody who's listening enjoys hearing us talk. Let's run through this list real quick. Okay, number one. Iron Man 4 with Robert Downey Jr. Do you want to see Iron Man 4? Mm-hmm. And the article says, the first rule of the Marvel Cinematic Universe is that nobody can get enough of Tony Stark, aka Iron Man. And that means that rumors of a fourth installment of his solo adventures during the franchise's Phase 4 would be the most welcome.
I don't want to see one.
I kind of do, because I love his character.
I like his character, Iron Man? I like his character, but I like this character pretty much... Like, I want to. I'm more curious. Avengers and everything. I'm more curious about Avengers and Infinity, like, than about his. Like, who does he fight? Like, who's. Like, they already fucked up Mandarin. Like, that was one of his biggest villains. They fucked up Whiplash was okay. Like, who else does he have? Who else does he fight?
Yeah.
Like, who else is his enemy?
I guess
enemy?
Who else can really last up to him? Yeah, I guess maybe that's why they haven't made one, because sometimes the well kind of runs dry on those things. Okay, so number two, another Hulk solo movie. These are 17 MCU Phase 4 rumors that we hope are true. 17 Phase 4 rumors that we hope are true. In Phase 4, do you want to see another Hulk solo movie?
If they bring in Red Hulk, yes.
That would be tight, right? Or like the Grey Hulk? A Red
or the
Grey
Hulk,
would
yeah.
be kind of cool, yeah.
Red Hulk would be dope. Red Hulk would be cool, too, though.
Yeah.
Like, they would need another Hulk. They already did Abomination. It's not much else than Brainiac. Mm. Nobody cares. Not Brainiac, but the big-headed... Nobody cares about him. Like, yeah. We need a fight.
Definitely, man. It says, the article says, the Hulk is set to appear in Thor Ragnarok.
Oh, that's good.
And the Avengers Infinity War movies. So,
good. Just fucking leave it. Yeah, we don't need it.
Fine. Okay.
If Hulk's in Ragnarok... If Hulk's in Ragnarok,
Thor?
Hulk and Thor fight.
Oh, can you get enough? Can you get enough Hulk?
I can totally get enough Thor. I've already had enough Thor.
Yeah. But, I mean, Hulk. I think Thor Ragnarok would be cool for the Hulk, because I've heard, you know, from articles I've read, that they're going to try to push it more like a... you ever seen the movie Planet Hulk? It's an animated
Hulk
movie.
Yeah, I have. Uh-huh.
Where he goes, like, he becomes a dangerous to the Earth, so the Avengers, like, trap him and send him in a rocket to, like, another planet, you know what I mean? Because he's so dangerous, he's such a monster. And he gets his other planet where he like, fulfills some prophecy and becomes, like, a king and a rebel, and he fights against the system there.
And he comes back.
If they tie that kind of a story into this Thor Ragnarok movie, it would be fucking awesome, because then we get to see the Hulk tear through a planet. You know what I mean? Like, with no restrictions and regulations, he could just fuck things up and go just hard.
They'll have to kill Valhalla. I think for them to do World War Hulk, then you would need they would need a Hulk movie that's just going to be for that.
Mm-hmm.
And they will have to pay enough for it to have the other Avengers launch his ass out in space. So,
well, I mean, if you got Tony Stark, you know,
and then we'd have to
Tony Stark has infinite money.
I don't know.
Okay.
It might be too much.
Next point, just because we have 17. Number three, a Black Widow solo movie, which technically she's kind of getting with Ghost in the Shell, her actress that portrays Black Widow.
Don't care.
Yeah, don't care. I don't. I'm like, Natasha Romanoff.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Like,
you're good.
Got her in that flashback. In that flashback in the last movie?
Mm-hmm.
Or the Age of Ultron? That was enough.
Yeah, just be a sidekick for Captain America or something like that. We don't need to see your own.
You're a ballerina assassin. I get it.
Okay, they got some random obscure ones here too, like Captain Marvel. Do you want to see a Captain Marvel movie?
Yes.
Don't know anything really so much about Captain Marvel.
Captain Marvel's awesome.
If they came out with it, I'm sure there would be a
Carol Danvers?
For it.
Yes. If they had Carol, yes. Captain Marvel movie needs to happen. We could bring a female hero into the Marvel universe, into the Avengers.
I mean, I guess, you know.
She's part of the Avengers.
It would probably hit, just like Doctor Strange. No, people don't really know a lot about Doctor Strange, but people are going to go see that goddamn movie when it comes out.
Is he going to be in the... He has to be in the next Avengers.
He has to be, because he's part of the Avengers, isn't he?
Yeah, yeah.
So he has to be drawn into that. So, yeah, man, it's crazy.
Even not directly, he's at least always affiliated with
Okay, next. I'm losing count of these, so I don't know how many we have left. A Blade reboot. Would you be interested in seeing a Blade reboot?
Only if it's Wesley Snipes.
In the Marvel Cinematic Universe Phase 4.
Call me old fashioned.
Only if it's Wesley Snipes, because he fits that goddamn role so well.
Yeah, he did
it.
He made it. He perfected it. It have to be Wesley Snipes.
We always talk about, like, black superheroes and stuff like that here on the Intelligent Idea Talkers podcast, but that's one that I think goes under the radar a little bit more than we would like, is Blade. Definitely a black superhero. One of the coolest superheroes. Half vampire, half human.
Ever made. Like, the best comic movies ever made for 97.
That first Blade. Even the second Blade, I will put under there.
Yeah, Blade 2 was better than Blade 1. But Blade 1 was dope as shit.
It was just hot, man. That was just a cool movie.
Actually, Blade 1 might have been better. I don't know. They're both good.
Probably not really so popular as, say, like, Captain America, Iron Man. Because, as I recall, wasn't that rated R?
It was.
Blade was rated R, yeah, because they were cussing it. I heard a couple of fucks and shits in there.
Decapitating
like
people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so, yeah, you can't market that to little kids. Okay, so, next one, a Ghost Rider reboot. Would you be interested in seeing Ghost Rider reboot?
Nope.
Nah. Yeah, I'm like, nah. I didn't like the first Ghost Rider. I think, did I see the second one with
He's not even a big deal.
Wait, Was there a second movie? Because wasn't Nicolas Cage the first Ghost Rider?
There was two movies.
I saw the first one then. I didn't see the second.
They both suck.
Don't care. Next one. Marvel Studios to reacquire the Fantastic Four. Please do this shit, man.
Wait a minute. Who has it now?
I think Fox or Sony.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
They had Spider-Man. God. So Spider-Man, that's why they've been fucking up all the other Fantastic Four movies. That's why this last Fantastic Four movie was so whack. They did it outside of the MCU. You know what I mean?
Jesus Christ.
Spider-Man
2. Please.
Spider-Man 2. He's owned by I think X-Men 2. They're owned by Sony or they're not owned by Marvel Studios. Right. You know what I mean? So that's why Spider-Man was on lease, I think. So he could only be in a certain amount of this last movie. Like they couldn't. So that's why I guess when they brought him in, they had to put their own kind of spin on him. So that's why his suit is different and the eyes moved and he wasn't just like that plastic Spider-Man like Tobey Maguire or some shit, you know? So
I mean, those Spider-Mans were good for the time, except for the last one. But
I don't
one
care about
two,
any of those after this Spider-Man I've seen in Civil War. Yeah. Like
one and two was good.
Spider-Man 1-2 was good with Doc Ock. I like that joint. I mean, one was good for what it was.
Three was horrendous.
It was good for what it was. Disgusting. Even they've had five Spider-Man movies since they started this whole comic book genre thing. Three with Tobey Maguire, two with the other dude, Andrew Garfield.
I like those.
I like them too, but I like the Civil War Spider-Man better. Yeah. I just do. Like, bring him into the fold. Bring Fantastic Four into the fold.
I like them too. I don't even like them.
You have to bring Fantastic Four in, man.
Yeah, you got
to
bring them back. You got to bring them back because Fantastic Four is so fucking important.
And aren't they?
They fucking left off with Galactus and Silver Surfer in the last one. Mm-hmm. Galactus was supposed to be coming. They fucked that whole shit up.
Mm-hmm.
How? And they made the Human Torch and Captain America, which I'm okay with now, but it took a while.
Definitely, man. Okay, so next, it says TV stars making the step up to the movies. This is 17 MCU Phase 4 rumors that we hope are true. And they specifically point out in this part of the article, TV stars making a step up to movies. Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Agent Carter, Daredevil, Jessica Jones have all been well received.
Okay.
With Luke Cage, Iron Fist, The Defenders, and Damage Control on the way.
We'll see how they do.
By 2019, Marvel's Netflix show, Daredevil, Jessica Jones, Iron Fist, and The Defenders will have come to an end. But it would be awesome if they could spin those out into solo movies, like a Daredevil movie. We were just talking about Daredevil. I would like to see a movie with that guy.
I would like to see it.
With that actor.
I don't want him to have his own movie. I think they should leave him with the series, because he doesn't need a movie with the series. But if they wanted to throw him into the Avengers, then that would be dope. Like, if they wanted to throw these characters into these movies, into these big movies, and however there were these big MCU movies, as side characters, I would totally be cool with that. Mm-hmm. You know, that would be a huge element of continuity.
And it would round out the universe. This guy's there. I'm watching this show on Netflix, but I know he's a part of the movie, the big screen.
I wouldn't want him to have his own movie, though.
A Daredevil movie?
I mean, I'd go watch it, okay, but so look, wouldn't need it, though.
This leads into the next... I'm just trying to run through them because we're running long. Leads it to the next one. They want to see more buddy movies. Do you want to see more buddy movies? And they point out Daredevil and Spider-Man. They teamed up for a comic book series. You know what I mean? They point out Ant-Man and the Wasp. You want to see more buddy movies?
Iron Man and
Bucky Barnes. Well, I guess with Civil War, that's never going to happen. Not Bucky Barnes, Iron Man, but Thor and Bucky Barnes. Or not Thor, but Captain America and Bucky Barnes. Or Black Panther and Scarlet Witch and Vision, or something like that, you know? Would you want to see movies where people buddy up?
I mean, it would be cool if
War Machine
Infinity
and Falcon
goes well.
War Machine and Falcon would be cool.
War Machine and Falcon would be dope. Mm-hmm. Black Panther, War Machine and Falcon would be dope.
Black Widow and Hawkeye.
I don't know.
I don't know about Black Widow and Hawkeye. It's two humans.
Black Widow and Hawkeye?
Two humies. I don't know.
Yeah, that would be
I need you guys to have some mutant powers or something like that, you know? I would like it. I would go see him. I'd go check him out. Right now, man, comic book movies are so popular. It's like you could damn near drop anything and people will.
I don't know. It would depend. It would have to depend.
All right. So next, a Namor movie. You know, Namor is the
world's first mutant.
Yeah. Well, he's the, I guess, the Marvel equivalent to Aquaman. You know, Namor. I remember seeing a couple comics. He was in a couple comics. I remember Captain America comics I was reading back in the day. He was in there.
Yeah, I would be cool without Namor movie.
Now's the time.
Yeah, you have to do it now. Or do it soon.
Mm-hmm.
I'll be down with it.
Namor's home is on the Atlantis. and they point out that he would make a great Avenger. He would add another dynamic element to the team that they don't already have. Sea power, you know what I mean? Which would be good. You'd have to tie him in, just like Doctor Strange. You'd have to drop a Namor.
Is he an Avenger, though? He's not an Avenger.
I don't think so. They said he would make a great Avenger. His rights apparently remain with Universal at present, but Marvel Studios have proven themselves capable of getting around such issues. So I think that's it. Spider-Man and Fantastic Four, they all are under the Universal umbrella. So they're not owned by Marvel Studios. Let me see. A Thunderbolts movie? I didn't know who Thunderbolts
is. So, yeah, that would be interesting. I think they're villains.
With potential it's team like members like Red Hulk, Punisher, Venom, the Green Goblin, Man-Thing.
It's like Suicide Ragnarok Squad, except they're not. They're independent.
It'd be awesome. So they're like mercenaries. They're like mercs.
Kinda, but they're a team. It's weird.
That'd be
like Sinister Six kind of shit.
That'd be kind of cool. Hey, and now is the time. If you're going to drop it, better drop it.
I mean, they could do it after Infinity. It won't matter when they do that.
Let's see.
They could be the next big villain set.
It says the Masters of Evil as villains. That's the next topic. The Masters of Evil. Probably about the same thing.
I don't know who's in that.
Loki, Mandarin, Red Skull, Abomination, the Leader, Helmet, Zemo.
They already killed two
Zemo,
of them.
Zemo was the guy from his last movie.
Dead.
Zemo's not dead? Zemo is dead. He was the guy on the computer.
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Zemo's dead and Mandarin's dead. So, however they did Mandarin, that shows whack. But
I think a lot of these, they were just kind of going off the cusp. Let's see. A Runaways movie. Runaways. I've never really been so up on the Runaways. Who's in there? Nico Minoru, the cyborg, Victor Mancha. Okay, whatever. We don't know these guys yet. Nobody would care about the Runaways.
Nerds.
Yeah, only nerds would care about the Runaways. Like, who the hell followed the Runaways?
Nerds.
And I'm trying to wait for this daggone page to load up. Sorry, guys. I'm at the mercy of technology here in my
phone network. Signal.
A Kazar movie. Kazar. Have you ever heard of Kazar? Actually, I think I did. Wasn't he the guy on... didn't he have like Sauron? He was like a He-Man kind of a guy. Wasn't he in like another dimension or something like that? I mean,
he was like the
Savage Land. Yep.
Yeah, the Savage Land. Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
I probably wouldn't care, but
probably don't care.
Let's see. He hooked up with numerous characters throughout his storyline. He's an expert hunter, trapper, fisherman who lives off the wild land. Who has encountered many heroes, X-Men, Magneto, Thanos, Spider-Man, Dr. Octopus, and Daredevil. So he's mixed in with all these other characters that we like. We just don't care about him particularly.
I think it would be cool if you brought Sauron. I think Sauron's actually a bigger deal than him. So they bring Sauron into like X-Men or some shit, and then maybe bring Kazar with them.
Okay, the Illuminati will make an appearance in an upcoming movie. The Illuminati.
Fucking down, son.
The Illuminati are an elite group of Marvel's finest superheroes.
But you gotta start our Reed Richards, because he's the head.
They do have him in here, too, yeah. They got Black Panther in there, yeah.
Panther, Richards, let me see. Professor X, Namor, Doctor Strange.
Black Panther, Captain America, Hank Pym, Doctor Strange, Hank Pym. Black Bolt.
All the leaders.
So wait a minute, can you be a member of the Avengers and a member of the Illuminati? Isn't that like a conflict?
The Illuminati is like a secret. Like a lot of people don't know about the Illuminati. Yeah, like not everybody knows about the Illuminati, but only a couple of them.
I figured that would be.
And then they kicked Captain America out with that jump. Racist memory.
They kicked Captain America out.
Yeah.
Oh damn.
During the Secret Wars, there's a whole thing.
Okay. Next is a Secret Invasion movie. Secret Invasion.
That's good.
Saw the Skrulls. Yeah. I remember the Skrulls. Where are they from?
They're the shapeshifter.
Man, they're really testing my my.
They look like Thanos background. With the chin.
Yeah, they do. Green. Yeah, I remember. Yeah, yep. Not interested. Who cares?
That would be dope.
It would be
because it's like a you have this one character and you find out, oh shit, actually wasn't that person. Then you have to wonder what happens to that person.
Do they want to invest the time and resources into making that movie?
It would be worth it, I think.
Yeah.
Because it'll be a twist.
Next is Kang the Conqueror as a villain.
Don't care.
Kang. When Thanos is finally defeated after the second Avengers Infinity War movie, only a handful of villains are worthy of taking his place. Step forward, Kang the Conqueror.
I don't know who that is.
He has a distant relation to both Reed Richards and Doctor Doom.
You got a picture?
It's that guy right there. Mm-hmm. You know, we definitely need to start recording video so we can put up, like, when we reference a video that we're talking about or any type of an article or picture, we can just put it up. So, like, when people are watching us on the channel, you know, our YouTube channel, they'll see, like, you know, we'll be recording so we can transition to a picture of what we're talking about and then come back to us recording. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. You know, we need somebody behind the scenes, behind the boards. Where's Stephanie? Damn it.
I need makeup, though.
Steph, get in here.
Who's going to do my makeup?
Yeah, I know, right? Stephanie. And it looks like that's it. It looks like that's it. I'm not sure if that was 17. Of course, I think they put the more exciting ones in the beginning, but definitely, man, I definitely would be down with another Hulk movie. Now is the time. Superhero movies have never been hotter.
Drop it. Like, a lot of movies are coming out. Dude, I was trying to go to the movie with my girl the other day. None of them shit look interesting.
You didn't see one that you like.
Goddamn movie looked interesting at all.
I saw Jason Bourne joint. I was like, I'm bored in this joint. Like, goddamn. Like, it wasn't as good as the last ones, man. Like, if you're not coming out with a comic book movie, just those shits are on such fire right now. Like, you know, it's a comic book movie or a kiddie movie, like The Zoo or whatever, Life of Pets, The Secret Life of Pets or something. Like, you have to come out with, like.
You see that?
No, but those movies make a ton of money.
Zootopia was good.
Zootopia made, it's like one of the top selling movies. What was the other Jonah?
I bought that shit from Scarlett.
What was the other Jonah with the little frost princess? You know, everybody was
Frozen.
Frozen. God damn, this movie made so much money, man. That movie was making more money than, I mean, just, it's like one of the top movies for weeks, you know?
Yeah,
so,
man.
You have to have a movie that kids can go see. Like, if you're going to drop any of these ideas, do it now while the iron's hot. But,
and if you're not making a Marvel movie,
that Thor Ragnarok might be kind of cool, though. Because remember in Civil War, they referenced in that movie, where were Thor and the Hulk? They said that joint in there. Like, where are they at? You know what I mean? Because the guy was like, if I misplaced a couple of 10-ton nuclear warheads, I'd be in trouble. You know
right,
what I mean?
Yeah.
So you're the leader of the Avengers, and you don't know where these guys are. The Hulk is a warhead. You know what I mean?
Yo, did you see? So there's a video my friend linked me in.
What Thor was doing?
Yeah,
I think I did see that, Joe. Yeah.
And he was with his roommate. Was his name Derek?
Come to Australia and relax. You know, just get away. He's like, me and Mjolnir. It's like, remember Mjolnir was sleeping in the drawer? He had that drawer some covers.
That's right. Yo, did he met with the Bruce Banner?
Yeah. He's like, hey, he's like, what's up, Tony Boney? You know what I mean? He's like, answer the ball, cool. He's like, he hasn't called me.
He's like, tell him to call me.
Yeah, he does.
Tell him to send a raven.
He said, you want me to put him on? Yeah, he said, I told him to send a raven in that joint.
Yo,
with that Eric Comic Con, right? Yeah, that was funny, man.
Yeah, that was
yo,
funny.
we gotta go to Comic Con one year, man.
Yeah, no,
we got to, man. That shit seems like it's so cool.
Does, man. That's why everything's released, man. Mm-hmm.
And if you're a nerd, you have to go to a Comic Con at least once in your lifetime, man. You have to, even if not Comic Con, like New York or even San Diego or just any kind of con. You know what I mean? Like, you have to go.
That's
like nerd's paradise. But yeah, I guess is that gonna take us to the end?
I guess that's
into
it,
the
man.
Cast, God, damn, we're
wrap that joint
like
up, man.
Hours.
We just hit the 2-hour mark, 2:03.
It's a hey, you know what? Juice usually does his edits when he's going through and trying to push out the final product. You said we just crossed the 2-hour mark.
Yeah.
After you do edits, it's probably gonna be like 1:58. You know what I mean? Like, we probably go like 2 minutes. Damn it. You know what, guys? We literally made a conscious effort to try to speed through topics and shorten the cast.
It's been so long, though. We had so much we wanted to talk about, you know?
No, dude, come on. Every cast we have lasts about an hour 45, 2 hours, though. Like, we just get to talking.
Yo, try to be positive in this gym.
We just get to talking, and the shit just kind of flows. But, yeah, man, so like, subscribe to the channel.
Leave a comment, you know? Let us know what you're thinking. Any recommendations or suggestions what to talk about next time, maybe some comments or what we talked about, we can have a discussion with that.
Definitely, man.
Yeah, we'd love to hear from you.
Appreciate you guys joining us if you are. Definitely, man. And hey, shout outs to Ace, our other co-host, couldn't be here tonight. Another shout out. Get better, Ace. We're gonna see you back here next episode.
See
right?
you next episode. All
I
right,
guess
everybody.
Signing off. That's D.
This is Juice.
Peace.